What's the name of that song?
I didn't believe you were a dancer until this very moment.
We're live.
By the way, just if you're wondering, folks, we are live episode number 72 with Tom Zender, Gerard Heron, and Meet Kevin is on his way. He's, what, 15 minutes away? He's he had 5 minutes away. Today's episode is sponsored by Vidal Sassoon. Obviously, Gerard's hair tells us. You know, look at our buddy here. What he's got.
Yeah, I was going to say, I like that.
I got the call. They called the right-hander from the bullpen today. I got the call. Mario,
Gerard,
it's 7 o'clock in the morning.
Up.
We've only seen him with a hat. I like it.
By the way, you know, I was wondering, you know, when they told me, you know, Kevin's having technicalities with flight coming in.
Yeah.
I thought maybe California was preventing the flight because I don't know if you guys heard it or not. California officially banned states travel to Florida and four other states over LGBTQ community
It would
laws.
Only make sense, right?
So I said, if this guy's running for governor, they do not let him come to Florida. Maybe they're upset about
Bottom
it anyway.
Bottom line, he's not going to get this flight reimbursed. Yeah. That's for damn
not
sure.
Gonna happen. Not going to happen.
The people of love and tolerance sure do love them some segregation, don't
hey,
they?
Man,
especially that state.
I'm from California.
Especially that state. Especially that state. So,
Pat, if I may, real quick.
Please.
Shout out to Emily in New Jersey. My sister, her 33rd birthday today, if I may. 33
happy,
for Emily.
Happy birthday.
Yes.
Happy. Is that the one you got the gift for? Or that's
a different the one that you helped me out with the gift for. Yes,
a really nice gift for her, man. That's good stuff. That's good stuff. Okay, well, happy birthday to her. Look, you were a reporter, Phoenix Suns, okay? You were in Arizona for a while. I mean, obviously, you did stuff with Michael Jordan. You did stuff with Barkley. You did stuff with a lot of those guys. But your main team was Suns for the longest time.
Totally.
How's it feel knowing these guys are advancing?
And by the way, how about my predictions lately? I said the Nets had no chance. I was right. I said it was going to be the Suns and Milwaukee in the finals, and I think that's where it's going to be. But it was exciting. I used to work for the Suns. I was the guy on the court, the hype guy, getting the crowd going during all the timeouts, you know, doing all the – it was like a game show host meets MC meets everything else. So I did that, you know, hundreds of games.
Yeah.
No playoffs. So it felt really good. And I took Dash. I said, they're going to clinch tonight, buddy. Let's go. I woke him up that morning and said, later this afternoon, we're going to fly in and out. Literally in and out. The arena's 5 minutes from the airport. We got in, got to the game. Unbelievable atmosphere. The Suns fans are so incredible. I thought they were going to clinch on Monday. They didn't. It was so much fun, but then they ended up doing it last night in L.A.
Yeah, Monday, Paul George just absolutely destroyed them with what he did in the fourth quarter,
yeah,
second
last
half.
Last night, incredible.
No.
Paul George. I can't stand him. And I can't stand
really,
Paul
you're
George.
Not a Paul
oh, my
George
God.
Fan.
I never have. He's the biggest choke artist in the history of the NBA playoffs.
Choke artist? 41 points?
Oh, I don't care. Wow. 41 points in a game that doesn't matter ultimately.
Oh.
What does he do in the third and fourth quarter?
Call
forget
Chris
about.
Paul? What do you call Chris Paul?
Well, now I call him a winner.
Until he wins.
Speaking of, as a commentator, you had to love. Did you see what Mike Breen did with Kawhi Leonard?
Yes.
How hilarious was that?
Kawhi was sitting there like this during the game.
Paul George hits a monster shot to put his team up by two with like 2 seconds to go.
Kawhi's like,
and Mike Breen, who I grew up with as a Knick fan, is like he's the perfect announcer. He's like, this place is going crazy. It's total mayhem. Somebody calm Kawhi Leonard down.
Yeah.
And Kawhi Leonard's just sitting there like this.
In a suite.
Like yawning.
Oh, that's awesome, man. I mean, that's his personality, though. I'm not surprised for him to be that way. So, look, we got things we're doing with California, which we'll get into here in a minute. But prior to getting into California, let's cover some other things that's going on here with stories that we have. Cosby. You guys saw Cosby, isn't it? There's two stories that's going on everywhere. Yeah. One is Cosby, one is Spears. You know, Britney Spears. So what do you think about what happened with Cosby?
Here, I'll jump out on Cosby. Yeah. It's like I wrote in VTPost.com. I said, raise your hand if you saw this one coming. I thought he was going to die in prison. We all did, right? I mean, it was a parade. Mm-hmm.
Did you see it coming?
God, no.
Nobody
oh,
saw
hell
it
no.
coming.
That's why I said, if you actually saw this coming, raise your hand, because nobody did. He was the first of the celebrities to go down in the hashtag MeToo movement.
Yeah.
He was numero uno when they got him. And it was just a progression. I mean, the guy is a grade A creep.
Yeah.
I mean, you cannot dispute that. But you know what? If you like this country, you should be very happy that he was released yesterday, because this all falls on that DA that charged him when they promised him he wouldn't.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And when you see what's going on with Trump, where they're spending millions and millions of dollars and just doing anything they can to fabricate something and find something, they promised him they wouldn't charge him. He then incriminated himself in a deposition in the civil suit. And then they came back, used that information, and charged him. So technically, he should be let go. This is a great country. It proves it right there. I don't like Cosby, but I like the fact he's out because
he should
let
go on that conviction. on that conviction.
On that conviction, yeah.
The fact that you know, they're considering this like double jeopardy, that he's not going to get, he's not going to go to trial for any of the other allegations and accusations is a little bit rough. And it really goes back to, you know, one, it kind of is the official end of Me Too, like you said. It's kind of the bookend on Me Too. I think, you know, once the Democratic Party was okay with, you know, President Biden bowling his interns, that, you know, then they didn't say anything about that. After years of Trump grabbing by the, you know, and then Biden is accused of actually literally doing that, and then that gets swept under the rug. That was the unofficial end of Me Too. They lost any foot to stand on. This is the end of it. You know, it's, I think Me Too, in retrospect, was a very important thing. I really do. I think that Me Too had its place. I think that especially with Harvey Weinstein,
yeah, number one.
Especially with LA, I think anybody who looks back at old school television, look at Richard Dawson on Family Feud on live television, just absolutely like aggressively just stealing people's mouths on TV. Like, okay, we needed to pull back on you know, the people that were abusing power. Absolutely needed it. But then it became just like everything else. It became politicized, and it became like a tool for people to use.
So is this a good thing with Cosby?
I think overall it's a good thing. I think anything that exposes what's wrong with our society in this moment of pain and change is good. I keep saying it, that we're entering an era of authenticity. You have to be honest and you have to be truthful. Everybody's going to find out everything eventually. And you're talking about that DA. Like, that DA needs to be prosecuted. Yeah. That DA needs to answer questions like, hey, as long as you help me get this other conviction, I won't prosecute your 27 rape allegations. Look, I don't want to put a famous black man in jail, so scratch my back and I'll scratch yours. That's not justice. And you know what? Unfortunately, that is justice in America. And we sat down with, we can't really talk about it, unfortunately, but we sat down with somebody very, very powerful for an interview last week. And my big takeaway from that interview, Pat asked some incredibly poignant questions. There's like no laws in this country. Everything is completely under interpretation at all times.
It's a scary thought.
It sure. All depends on what the prosecutor
the
wants.
Is under interpretation right now, the history of the country.
It's what the prosecutor wants to go after, and that's it. The prosecution, right. The prosecutors and the courts are the most powerful things in this entire country.
You see the videos too of they're not charging anybody for thefts under $1,000 in California. The 27 Walgreens in the San Francisco Bay Area had to be shut down because of all the crime. People walk in there, take what they want, and leave. Yeah. And then if you get these Soros appointed DAs, you're in real trouble if you live in a city like that.
Yeah. Yeah, well, St. Louis, LA. St. Louis, the people that were holding their firearms, you know what I'm saying? Those were the ones that the DA wanted to bring under prosecution,
but they didn't.
No, because of public pressure.
Sure,
and that's why things like this are
so
important.
What's up, Kevin?
Hey,
how you doing?
Welcome. I saw somebody just donated $500 to your live stream.
Did they?
They want an interview. I saw.
Gerard, nice to meet you. Nice suit you got there.
Thank you so much.
Yes,
it was a pleasure. Thank you so much. Wow, and Starbucks. Oh my gosh.
We're ready for you, buddy. We're ready for you.
As an Irishman myself, I can appreciate this.
So Kevin,
hey, all right, bro.
Why meet Kevin? Why is it meet Kevin? Tell us.
Yeah, why meet Kevin? No kidding. Well. My last name's always been something people are like, what's your last name? Path, like something, what? So I went with Meet Kevin because it was much simpler than Paffrath when I started selling real estate.
Oh.
Now, though, that's a little bit of a problem because when you're running for governor and you got three Kevins in the race, differentiating yourself as Meet Kevin doesn't work too well.
I got to say, I like Meet Kevin, though.
Thank you.
I actually like Meet Kevin.
You know,
Kevin.
As a Democrat, though, running in California, did anybody try to sway you to change your name to Vegetarian Kevin?
Oh, man.
I mean, that would...
I've had a lot of people try
vegan
to
Kevin. Vegan Kevin. Yeah.
Vegan Kevin.
Yeah, my mind immediately, as a political operative, my mind immediately went to Meat Swing. So, you know, that's the, yeah, but.
Different kind of Meat Kevin, right?
Yeah, complete different. So how was travel coming in? Tell us about it.
I'll tell you this. When you come into Florida and you look at that sunrise, it just makes you want to go live at the beach. And you guys have such a beautiful state here.
So where are you in California?
I'm in Ventura, California, which we've got beaches too. Water's a little bit colder, and you've got an oppressive regime that makes life a little more miserable.
Are you Ventura or are you Oxnard?
Ventura, city of Ventura.
You are in Ventura.
Yes, that's
okay,
right.
Great. Yep. Yeah, I mean, I've been in Ventura many, many times. Ventura's what, 10 miles after Camarillo, or like 15 miles after Camarillo?
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's an
interesting California. By the way, Oxnard produces some of the best fighters in America.
Is that right?
Oxnard has some of the best fighters. Some of the, you know, sickest boxers, fighters come out of Oxnard.
Did you see the Mayweather thing about how that may have been all
gotta help them out?
Come on, man. I paid $50 for that fight. I'm like,
wait a minute.
You get what you paid for, bro.
The part about him picking him up, is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
Did you see how much he got paid for?
But you know what? I got what I expected for the $50. You know what? Although I did want some mayhem. I wanted just a shit show, to be
honest.
Blood,
man.
With
where's the blood?
Yeah.
Look, the part I will tell you. Here's what I will tell you. I watched it first round, second round. I'm like, oh my gosh, this thing's absolutely boring. Logan actually looked pretty good. But then by the fourth round, you're like, no, this is why this guy is Mayweather.
Yeah.
This is, for 21 years, he dominated the game.
Yeah.
Love him or hate him, the level of quickness he has, at what age was he, 40-some years old, going up against Logan?
Well, he did the same thing with McGregor.
Yeah.
He carried McGregor for four rounds. I mean, say what you want. He could have ended that fight any time.
Okay.
Like, he's so bored in the boxing ring.
Question
for he's
you.
So bored. He's like, okay.
Street fight. Who wins?
Oh, it's not even close.
Okay.
It's not even close.
Okay, who?
McGregor destroys him.
You take Street Fight McGregor?
No, it's not even close. No. Time out. I take McGregor 2 years ago before he sold his alcohol. He's soft now. No way.
Say it to his face, dog.
Conor McGregor in a street fight? No way.
He would not say to his face, messing up his suit or his manicure.
There is no way
Conor McGregor wins a street fight.
I think Jake Paul would beat him in a street fight. Apologize to Conor McGregor's tailor right now. You know what? He's not the same Conor McGregor, and you guys are going to find out when you shell out $75 for the fight on July 10th.
I agree with you. I used to train MMA. I used to fight. And there's dudes that I would fight with that are big-time fighters now, and I won't say their names, but they basically said to me 2 years ago, never bet Conor McGregor ever again. Ever. They have to drag him into the gym. They have to drag, like, he does his training camps in Monaco now.
Are you saying to, look, you can't,
that said,
Tom, you can't say that.
In a street fight today.
Stop it. It's not going to happen.
Hey, time out here. This is America. I can have my opinion, right?
Did you see what James Toney did?
Not on this podcast.
Okay, listen, I am going to make this a little bit more interesting.
You can have an opinion. It's just wrong.
Time out.
Turn Kevin down.
I got the whole, like, show in my head.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah, if you think this is rough, wait till the Democrats get you, boy.
Oh, no. Oh, man. Oh, wow.
Are we good now or no? Good?
We're back.
All right, we're back. So to finish this off, you're saying Mayweather would beat Conor in a street fight and Logan Paul in a street fight.
Yes, unequivocally,
kicks,
I'm saying
everything.
That. Anything.
All right, it is what it is. Yeah. No one's perfect. We'll let you have that. Okay, so Kevin, kind of walk us through, for those who don't know your story, your background, how you came about real estate, YouTube, growing it, talking finance, talking stimulus, to now running for governor.
Oh, man. The whole
Give us your
caboodle.
Story. Give
yeah,
us your
I mean,
story.
Basically, I was moved from Florida, from out here, Davie, Florida, to California at 17 to live with my now wife. We have two kids, two beautiful kids. I miss them already. And, you know, I was in going to high school half days for my senior year in California. Decided this is boring. I got to do something. I was working at Jamba Juice. And my wife decided, hey, I'm going to get my real estate license. So I thought, okay, well, I may as well get that as well. I wasn't planning on being a real estate agent. But when I got my license, I'm like, wait a minute. College isn't going to make me money. I need to do something myself. But yeah, certainly not what they're teaching right now. Algebra, I'm not going to learn anything with. The stuff I was learning in school, it was incredibly boring for me. And I think for most
people. Are you a math guy or not?
I mean, I love numbers.
Yeah.
I love the numbers I care about. Like stocks and options.
Yeah, practical application.
Come on. Yeah, I don't want to know the area of a slice of an apple. You know what I'm saying? And that's what I was learning in college. Throughout college, I began growing my real estate business. That did really well. I'd sit down with people at places like Starbucks, the best free office you could get because it advertises your business while you're working. People see you working in the coffee shop. I'd had clients, they'd call me and go, I see you in the coffee shop every week, man. Can you sell my house too? It's great. And so that's how I'd meet clients.
How
as well.
Old are you at that time when you're doing this?
Oh, I started at 18, 19.
18 years old, hustling.
Oh,
that's the part about the story.
And I told everyone I was 23.
Now you look like, did you have a beard at the time?
No.
Or okay. All right. So you looked 18.
I looked 18.
All right. Okay.
People are like, oh, okay. All right. Mitchell, okay. But hey, maybe the suit added a couple of years or whatever. I don't know. But yeah, I mean, it was just a grind. And I did that while I was in college. And I always thought, if you're in college, you're kind of at the same starting line as everybody else. I felt like I could do whatever I wanted to, and I could fail as many times as I wanted to, because probably when I graduate college, I'm at the same starting line as everybody else. Most people aren't running far ahead in college.
Mm-hmm.
But business did really well, took off, almost dropped out of college because income was coming in, taught people how to invest in real estate, and that then translated to YouTube in 2017.
Hmm. Very cool. So mm-hmm. high school, 16 years old, 15 years old, who's Kevin?
Kevin is a police explorer, volunteering 3,000 hours of my life to domestic violence, homeless calls,
really?
Police chases,
wow.
Everything, traffic control, everything. We'll have to put up a picture.
Are you a 4.2 GPA guy? Are you one of those guys? Are you
a
3.0
guy? Like the
4.0
was sixth grade and then my first 2 years of college. But beyond that, it was Counter-Strike, Halo, Splinter Cell.
Got it.
Volunteering with the police department didn't get you into the parties. So it was police and then games.
So why run for governor? Why run for governor?
Well, the big reason I'm running for governor.
Can you pull up his website, please?
Well, thank you for that. I am tired of seeing what's happening in California. All my friends are leaving. People are getting squeezed out, and it's because we have a very oppressive regime of...
Stay at the top. We'll go through it here.
Trying to tell you how to live your life and how to run your life. Taxes are too high. We're ranked 40th in schools. It's ridiculous. We should be ranked 1 in schools in California with the money that we collect. And we get misled by our leaders. You know, we get told we have a surplus. Meanwhile, we're going $12 billion in debt to forgive people's traffic tickets. It's some of the things that are going on. Some of the policies feel really criminal. The voters of California legalized cannabis in 2016. 90% of cannabis businesses are still struggling with provisional licenses to even be remotely legal. And so most people still sell it illegally.
So, Kev, let me ask you. So what is that due to? You said policies, right? Due to policies. Are those liberal policies or are those capitalistic, you know, conservative policies?
Well, my big thing is I believe that the first thing we need is a leader that focuses on solving the real issues that we have. And there are four massive ones.
Okay.
Housing, schooling,
yep.
homelessness, traffic. To me, those are bipartisan priorities.
Can you say that one more time? Housing, homelessness?
Housing, homelessness, traffic, schools. Those are bipartisan priorities. I don't care if you're Republican. I don't care if you're Democrat.
Yep.
Nobody wants to see homeless people dying on the street. We have more people dying on the street to homelessness than we do to gun violence in California. We've got ridiculous traffic. We talked about schools already, and housing's unaffordable. We know that. So people are getting squeezed out. On top of that, we tax at some of the highest tax rates in the country. So it feels like taxation without representation.
What kind of a Democrat are you? You're running as a Democrat, but not a lot of your policies seem like Democratic policies. Like, it doesn't sound like a Newsom policies. It doesn't sound like a Brown policy. it doesn't even sound like an Arnold policy. Some of your policies are even a little bit further right than Arnold's would be. So
how do you see yourself as
a Democrat?
I see them as Californian policies. I think what are the problems that we have?
Yeah.
And then how can we reasonably solve them? And in my opinion, we have incredible opportunities to stop wasting money on things like the high-speed rail. They're spending $125 million a mile on a high-speed rail that's going from Bakersfield up to NorCal. Why? They say it's for economic benefits.
It's a joke.
Cato did a study on it. They said economically it's break-even at best over 70 years, and it'll take that long to be carbon neutral. It's a waste of money.
Well, if you're going to go that far, go all the way. Say why it's costing that much money. Who owns the land and who's selling it?
Well, let's also be real about this.
Nancy Pelosi, Dianne Feinstein, Gavin Newsom.
You know,
we'll be honest. It's public record.
Hey, you know what else is public record? Is the husband of Dianne Feinstein donates to Gavin Newsom's recall campaign, and he is a contractor on the high-speed rail.
Is that so? There you go.
Just Google.
So I mean, you know, if you're going to use bipartisanship as a talking point, mm-hmm. which I applaud you for, mm-hmm. you have to be willing. Accountability is the first part of bipartisanship.
Ah,
right?
You know what you need is transparency. So, you need a YouTuber in government. So we can do daily vlogs and show what it's really like back there.
Mm-hmm.
How many shady contracts are going out when you're making YouTube videos going, these are the options we got. We got this contract from Tesla. We got this one from, you know, Ford. And we got this one for this. Well, what's the best one?
Mm-hmm.
becomes a whole lot easier to stop seeing money go to shady places when you're transparent about it.
Absolutely.
But the more and more regulation they have, the more money gets funneled into dark pools and dark ways of spending. The more restrictions, the more California tries to enter your life, the shadier it actually gets.
So let me go back to the question. By the way, great job on deflecting three times.
There
so
was. Yes.
I'm gonna go back.
Yes.
I'm gonna go back.
Yes.
I'm gonna go.
Welcome to the Thunderdome, bitch.
You have what it takes. You have what it takes. FYI, just so you know, here's what you need to know.
Let's hear it.
I am so glad you're running.
Oh, well, thank you.
You have
for that.
To know. I am so glad you're running. I am so glad you're running in a state that I lived in for 24 years.
Wow.
I'm glad a guy like you is running.
Well,
but
why'd you leave?
Let's go. I'll tell you. But let's go back to it. So as a Democrat, everybody who is a Democrat or Republican, they have somebody that they say he was a good president. I like the way he did it. Who's your guy?
Look, I think I'm a policy guy. I look at answers. I'm not trying to deflect you. I look at policies. Look, I think there are great things that Obama did. Some things were great. A lot of things weren't great.
What did you like? What did you like about what he did?
Look, there are some things that were good that Trump did too, right? And there's some things that Trump did that weren't great. I am so in the middle. I don't love identity politics.
I agree
politics.
With you, though. But I agree with you.
Yeah.
I don't see... And here's where I'm going with
this.
I'm going with... I think it's time... But by the way, I'm not trying to corner you.
No,
like, I want to hear you say what you liked, Obama. I want to hear you say what you liked about Trump.
Yeah.
But I think we're at a time where there are people on the left who don't identify with today's left.
Yeah,
there are people on the right that do not identify with today's right. That's why we have MAGA. With MAGA, but there are Republicans that do not identify with MAGA. There's a lot of people that don't identify with MAGA. I just thought, you know, maybe when I was looking, I said, okay, Kevin's going to be running. You did one thing. Guy sent me a video saying this guy's running. I said, I would love to see this guy run. Because what it would do is it would inspire. You know how when Reagan ran, like, Hollywood. Remember the whole movie Michael J. Fox when they go all the way back and says, "Oh, you know the actor, you know the B actor.
Oh, yeah,
he's
yeah,
going to
yeah,
be a president." Future, it's like,
right.
He's going to be president. That guy's your president. No, he's not. The actor, yes, but he opened it up for other people. If it's not Reagan, Trump's probably not running because Trump's just kind of like, "Well, I'm going to go do it." Right?
Sure.
I think it's a time where we have a candidate that runs and shakes it up on the independent side. I don't think you're a Democrat. I think you're independent.
Wow.
By the way, I don't see you as a Republican either, so I don't see you as a Republican.
Pat, can I ask him like a follow-up
to
you?
I'd love to, yeah.
Okay.
Bring it on.
You're a young, smart, strategic guy. I mean, you're very successful. You get instant feedback, you know, being a YouTuber and everything, so you have a hand on the pulse.
Good and bad.
Okay, but listen, you have to be strategic if you're going to do what you do. You'd have no chance to win if you came out as a Republican. Was part of your strategy to become a Democrat or run as a Democrat because it would at least get you in the door and maybe have a shot?
My belief is I'm so in the middle that I've been a registered Democrat, and to me I feel like I'm a 51-49. That's where I feel like I am. So when you're asking me for, you know, specifically this president or this, that or whatever, it's so close. But I'll tell you this, and this is not something I flip-flopped. I've been registered since I was 18. As a Democrat in California, I understand that California has a supermajority of Democrats. California, if a Republican gets in, California is wasting the next year. Because the next year under a Republican means Democrats just block it until the next election to get a Democrat in
Which
again.
Which is the next
it's
year
very interesting.
For
it's
the governor.
One year.
So
yeah.
two follow-ups on that. It's very, very interesting. We did an interview with Ron Paul, and Pat asked him straight up. You can actually watch the interview on Valuetainment. Asked him straight up, you're a libertarian. You're not a Republican. Why did you run as a Republican? And you remember what he said? He goes, I wanted to win.
You can as an independent.
He said, I would have never won my county
But I tell you one thing, Gerard. Here's where I go with that. I think today, by the way, even when you're asking him questions, you know, it's like, well, you know, I like Obama's policies, Trump's policies. What is it? Well, you know, it's just I don't want to do identity politics.
Yep.
People are scared today to run and just kind of be locked in into a community.
Of course,
right?
Yeah.
But here's where I go with you. This is where I go with you. I'm telling you, when I think about Blue Ocean Strategy, Blue Ocean Strategy. You know the concept of Blue Ocean Strategy, the book, you know, increase, decrease, eliminate, create, right? Increase, decrease, eliminate, create. By the way, take a minute and grab something. You haven't had something yet. So if there's ever been a time, you know, the whole thing, if there's ever been a time where you should buy gold, today's the time.
Today.
If there's ever been a time where you should invest
there's
in
no
the
greater time.
That's right. Right. Yeah. If there's ever been a time where you can actually run in the middle with the argument of are you a like this be my campaign. Yeah. Are you on the right, but you don't fully identify with everything people are saying on the right? Are you on the left, and you fully don't identify with everything that's being said on the left? For example, if you're a Democrat, you're a registered Democrat, and you're a Kennedy Democrat, maybe you're a Bill Clinton Democrat, good president, right? Forget about what he did.
Not a communist.
He was a good, not a communist, but he was a good president, right?
Not Bill Clinton. A commie.
Okay, maybe you relate with a Bill Clinton Democrat, right? Maybe you relate with a, you know, a different kind of a Republican, not a Trump Republican. Time for a third party, and let's go get the independent. Ron Paul got close. Our buddy, the Texas, what's his name?
Ross Perot
got close.
18%.
I think if there's ever been a time to do that, I think it's today. So why don't we do this? Before we get into Groovy a little bit more, can you pull up the website to just go through some of his policies? Kai, just pull up the website. Okay. Where's
the money in the middle come from, Pat?
From people like us. I swear to God. People like us have money. There's people like us. Independents have money. You have to understand, independents are very wealthy. People don't realize how much money is in the independent camp. Independents are sitting saying, somebody had the balls to go run on independent. Let me come and be your flag carrier.
I'll tell you the problem with that. I'm going to come and back you up.
Now, his position, like same reason why Trump didn't run on independent. Trump's not a Republican.
No.
Trump's never been a Republican. No. Trump's probably independent, maybe center left a little
bit.
He's not a Republican.
Absolutely.
But he knew he had to do it to kind of win. So you kind of have to go to a party. The state he's in, can you imagine if he ran as a Republican? Oh. They destroyed this guy.
You get no media coverage whatsoever. I mean,
well, go ahead. You were going to say something.
Yeah, so here's the thing. Why do we have a two-party system in this country? It's because when you want a campaign manager, the good ones are either on the Democratic Party or they're on the Republican Party. There's no good campaign manager that's really trying to run a business at some other party, at least that I can find anywhere.
Well, to Pat's points, because there's no money there.
Well, maybe that's exactly all the money's funneling into the party funnels, and so that's where the jobs are, and so here's what happens. You know how hard it is to run a campaign in California as a Democrat when if any Democrat from California I hire is immediately branded as being anti-Newsom and being part of the Republican recall?
He's done.
It's really hard.
Yeah, I can see that.
That person's entire career, well, you supported a recall.
Yeah.
You know, it's a disaster how aligned, how party identified it is. So that's why I'm running on Fix California. I'm running on my big five priorities. We've got rallies coming up this weekend and next weekend, and we've got a 20-point plan. The top five priorities are the ones we've been talking about.
Well, let's do this. Folks, if you got questions, send your questions on Twitter at Patrick Bay David, hashtag PBD Podcast, hashtag PBD Podcast. We'll address some of the questions. But let's go through your website.
Let's see if you
haven't been to his website, this is his website, meetkevin.com. So here's his plan. You got plans in Fresno, Sacramento, San Bernardino, San Diego is going all over the place. Go why yes on recall. Keep going up a little bit. California is beautiful. We've just lost our edge. Why yes on recall. False claim, governor claim. We have $75.7 million in surplus. California suggesting fact. He's going through numbers. Keep going lower. Because on the bottom, I think he's got what he stands for. Keep going lower. Mm-hmm. Keep going lower. Keep going lower.
There you go.
Number one, no homelessness in our streets within 60 days.
Bingo.
That's number one. Number two, massively reducing crime through new community style policing. And integration with future schools. Number three, future schools, and $2,000 per month for each attendee over 18 years old. Interesting. We'll come back to that one. Mm-hmm. Making housing affordable. Okay, keep going. Ending bad traffic and better roads that also pay us. Next, no state income taxes on the first $250,000 of income. Fully legalized gambling.
Yeah, on that one.
Fixing our immigration issues. No more blackouts, no COVID 2.0 lockdowns, lowering the cost of gas, leading our unions, nonprofit agencies and business, higher pay for teachers, firefighters, and police, massive fire prevention effort. That's big right there. A lot of people, that's number 14, but that could be big for the people that are close to that. They're affected by that a lot. Ending our water shortage, big issue in California, substantially reducing gun violence, the underground handy person, economy, energy, and homes, new net negative communities, day one executive action, and in California, transition bond. So you got all these things. The 14
I want to vote
about.
For that. That's what I want. Yeah. I want that.
That
is
me,
a California that works.
That, to me, sounds like a Republican or an independent running. Ooh. Okay? That's what, to me, sounds like, which is, by the way, again, I get it. I understand why. But
I think you said you're Republican or independent. That means you like it so much you want it to identify with your side.
No, I don't. I just understand. Look, so at this point, everybody knows who we sat with last week. Mm-hmm. Okay, everybody knows who we sat with last week.
Okay,
On the McAfee video that I did yesterday, You know, we had a full day with Giuliani last week at his place, full day, few hours of interview, and some of the stuff he said, let me just put it to you this way. We put on YouTube, YouTube's not going to be happy. They can't buy YouTube, right? And it's out of control, to say the least.
Explosive.
So now, here's the message that comes back. The message is, hey, you shouldn't be afraid of freedom of speech. You should put it up there and all this other stuff. And yeah, okay, YouTube has the right to also give you a strike and kind of mess up with your platform, all this other stuff. You know how that works out because when you're around...
You know, I covered Trump rallies as well as Biden rallies. I cover both.
Well, there was not too many rallies, Biden rallies, but that's...
Fair. Yeah. But I would cover them. I've literally had Trump rallies that I would just cover from a news POV. Hey, let's see what is being said. Completely deleted from my channel. Just completely removed.
Really?
Never had a Biden one removed. And YouTube will just send me a notification.
Why do you think?
You know, they use the incite violence argument, so they've gone through and then, he said this here, so delete it.
And it's not like you're a pro-Trump guy. You're not going up there saying, this guy's the greatest of all time. You're just kind of giving you commentary.
There's no such thing as leftist violence in this country.
They didn't want people
to
see the energy, the excitement.
I don't know what it is, but it's, you do see that. So there is, and unfortunately, that as somebody who covers news very neutrally on my channel, that does kind of mold what you want to cover. Because do I want to spend 3 hours covering something?
That's
and then
right.
They're like, guess what? You're getting paid nothing.
So Kevin, you know? You're a smart guy. What are your thoughts on censorship? And as a YouTuber, there's plenty of other YouTubers out there. How do you address that?
Oh, yeah. I mean, there's obviously always a balance to everything. But I think sometimes, or the needle right now is too far to the extreme.
You think there's
censorship.
A balance on censorship?
Well, I mean, look, there are some things. Like, if somebody's live streaming a mass shooting, that should be censored, right? That should not be live streamed.
But that doesn't happen. I mean,
has happened.
Well, but okay, why?
Well, what do you mean? Why? Well, okay, well, you want to get into the fundamental.
Yeah.
So, well, I mean, look, that's a simple one. If somebody can live stream a mass shooting and become internet famous for a few hours, create internet celebrity, and then die and kill themselves or whatever, what does that do? That motivates others to be martyrs and do the same thing.
Okay.
With that, society has to censor that. So there is, as with everything, there's a spectrum. There's the middle, there's one extreme, and there's the other. Right now, I think we're a little bit too far to one extreme, but we can't be zero either.
Okay. Well, it's interesting, right? Because you talk about what is, I guess, to your point, all right? And it's a good point
that you
made.
You guys got shot glasses? We have a party next?
It's a good point that you made.
You drink tequila or no?
Let's go.
But you're talking
you
about,
tequila?
Yeah.
You're talking
right.
about.
So maybe we'll have some tequila in a minute.
Yeah. So it's a good point that you make, but you're talking about incentivizing behavior and de-incentivizing behavior, disincentivizing behavior, right?
Yeah.
And specific to this. To your point, okay, and it's a good point, well made. They're literally disincentivizing telling the truth.
Well, yeah.
So they're using the excuse of you can't cover a mass murder because it would incentivize mass murder, and that's fine. Okay, fair. Now the pendulum is currently they're literally disincentivizing truth telling. You literally have to just regurgitate our lines, say the party line, or have your entire business shut down.
Where are you seeing this? In journalism or on YouTube or everywhere?
And this is not something that I'm making up. This is something Bill Maher has covered extensively. Okay. This is something that even John Stewart, this is people that are on the quote-unquote left, are actually finally starting to catch up. Russell Brand talks about this all the time. And this is a situation specific to us where Patrick is literally, we had a meeting 2 days ago where people in a project, a very, very expensive project, are begging him not to go forward with this information, which has since been corroborated.
After they've already talked about it?
After it's already been talked
we've
about.
We've not released it to anybody.
Okay.
We've not released it to anybody.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
So, again, I understand the point. So if the point of not showing something is to disincentivize it, are they not showing, specifically, and I have to be honest with you, the tech companies in California who tend to be Democrat and liberal, are they intentionally, to use your word, disincentivizing the truth?
I don't know if it's intentional. I think there is, I don't know. I don't know. I think it deserves more looking into. I mean, I think that's one of the things, the beautiful things about, if you get in to a position of power, you become governor, you see much more. And you could take the same reason that we use on my YouTube channel or in this discussion, and you can apply it with the actual information that we have. Because look, we don't have all the information. Like you said yourself, we don't have all the information as outsiders. I'd love to know more.
When
about
you have that information, let's say you get in as governor, okay, and you have a big lion backing you that maybe you can go toe to toe with some of these tech companies.
Yeah.
What would you do? Let's just say you have some information. You come from YouTube. You come from the tech world. You're sitting there, and it's Zuckerberg. It's Dorsey. It's whoever runs the Google conglomerate right now. You're at the room with them, and you say, "All right, this censorship thing. What are we going to do about it?" And your solution is.
Well, it all comes down to nuance. It's the same thing when folks want to know, how do I invest in real estate? There's no one answer. I've got to know the details.
Kevin,
can
I push back a little bit?
So
let me tell you what the audience is saying.
Yes, here.
The audience is saying, Kevin, why are you being a politician? I'm just telling you, they're saying, I'm not saying it to you. They're saying, Kevin, why don't you just tell us how you feel instead of deflect. Huh? Charlie says deflect.
You want to hear it?
Yeah, I want to hear it.
Let's hear it.
Tell us.
The answer is, I don't spew bullshit when I don't know the answers. I get the facts. And when I get the facts, I make videos that are accurate and I provide information that's accurate. If I get asked questions I don't know the answer, guess what? I'm going to have the balls to say I don't have the answer.
So if somebody thinks
that's being a politician, then don't vote for me. But the reality is you're going to get the truth from me and I'm going to get the facts before I say bullshit.
Okay, so let's go to what you just said. Okay, you said you were covering the Trump campaign.
Mm-hmm.
That's a fact.
This is a fact.
So you were covering the Trump campaign.
Correct.
This is not a hypothetical. This is your experience as a YouTuber.
Yes.
Those videos disappeared. Why did they?
Well, but again, YouTube makes the argument that Trump was inciting violence. I believe that's too far. I believe that goes too far.
Okay, so how do you address that?
Well, as governor, you can certainly address that. But again, we've got to get into all of the details. I want to see what's going on in the back rooms. I want to see who are the people making the decisions. Are these algorithms making decisions? Do those need to be tweaked? Because we know algorithms have a lot of human bias, and that human bias gets amplified. You see, there's so much more nuance in everything in our lives, in our society. There's so much more nuance. And when we look at the actual details, like we break apart the high-speed rail, and we go, oh my gosh, it's $200 million a mile through hilly areas and $100 million a mile through flat areas, all of a sudden we're going, why aren't we building tunnels for $10 million a mile? The point is, when we get the facts, we can give answers. If I don't have the facts, I can't give you an answer. So why don't we move on from censorship and get on to another topic where I can give you some answers?
the challenge is, Kevin, you're running for governor in a state that Facebook's in. You're running in a state where everyone that's doing that is a big part of your state you're running. So if you don't have an answer for that, voters are going to be like, I don't know about this. Because to be able to go face these virtual, for example, let me ask you a simple question.
Let's hear it.
If tomorrow Facebook or Google said, hey, we want to back up your campaign, would you support it?
Well, look, here's the thing. I have donations right now that average $50 per person. If one media or one tech company came in like they do for Gavin Newsom, the co-CEO of Netflix donated $3 million to Gavin Newsom.
Hastings.
Exactly. Reed Hastings. That's a lot of money. And the problem is, in California, you have to make sure that you're not going into office with a ton of strings attached. And that's how I want to run my campaign, is I want to go in as a transparent YouTuber, as a transparent business person, not with political baggage. People ask me, what's the difference between you and a politician who's been in for 20 years? Well, I'll tell you the difference. They've got 20 years of political baggage and favors to pay back. I'll take donations from anybody who supports my plan, my 20-point plan. You support that 20-point plan, you're willing to help make that happen. Facebook comes to me and says, Kevin, your idea of future schools, that's what we want. We will fund that $2,000 a month because we're going to show you how to educate people in future schools so that we can hire them at 18, debt-free, and they can have a career rather than 33% of Californians going on Medi-Cal. I support that. Facebook comes in and goes, look, you know, this $3 million is conditioned upon you supporting all our censorship. Then F off. It ain't going to happen. So again, there's nuance in absolutely everything. Somebody comes in, says, I support your plan. I want that kind of California. Let's go. Let's work together.
I'll be honest. I like the answer because politicians can say anything they want to that audience at that day and then change it the next day. I mean, I think there's some value in being able
I got to tell you this. Here's the thing. Like, good for him for giving the answer that he gave, which means if Facebook or Google gave, he would accept the money.
Yes.
He didn't say, I wouldn't take a penny from them. And then 6 months later, you find out he just took $6 million, whatever the amount is, from them. Yeah, so that's good. That's a good answer. That's a real answer. So yeah, the audience cannot make a decision.
You're always going to get the real answers, but that doesn't mean I have all of the answers.
In fairness, in fairness to Kevin,
that's fair to you.
He's already in 20 minutes been asked more hard questions than any Democrat in the last 4 years. So congratulations
to
you.
Bring him on, man.
Get off the plane, too.
Bring him on, man.
Now, so you said you're a Democrat since when?
Well, when I was 18, I registered as soon as I could.
Okay, so
got a credit card too.
That's interesting. My buddy, who in fairness is a political operative in New Jersey, okay, and he is a Republican. He posted Harry Reid in 2012 when this is in response to there's a shot putter who didn't want to stand for the American flag during I'm sorry for the national anthem, and it became a thing. It
was kneeling in that.
So there was.
There you go.
Which one do you want? Pick it.
What do you want?
I'm not a hard liquor guy anymore.
Pick.
You're
running
my
for governor.
Tickets.
Lead us. Which one do you
want? All right, we're going for this one.
All right, we're going with
Let's
this.
Go.
Here we go.
So, long story short, he posted how far the Democrats have gone. All right, because I believe that, you know, I've been center for a long time. Now people think I'm right.
Answers,
and I'm wondering if I've gone right.
I'm taking it as well.
Or if the country's sprinted left.
It's the first time we're doing this on live.
Why are we doing the tequila?
Anyways, we're just going to have it. Keep going. This is good.
So, in 2012.
Because y'all getting rolled by Meet Kevin.
In 2012, Meet Swing Kevin. So, in 2012, Harry Reid actually said when he found out that the uniforms, the United States of America uniforms for the Olympics were made in China, he said, don't send the teams and burn the uniforms. That was Harry Reid, about as far left a progressive as you can get at the time. We've gone from Harry Reid saying burn the uniforms because they were made in China in 2012 to in 2021, CNN posting a glowing review of the 100-year anniversary of China. So you've been a Democrat for 10 years now. What have you 11. Seen happen? 11 years. What have you seen in the party over that time? Have you seen a far left sprint from that party, and do you still identify with them as you did?
Well, you always have extremes, right? You've got like the AOCs on the very far. You got Rand Paul on the very far, right? And what's happening is you've got Fox and you've got CNN catering their programs to the extremes because it creates the views. You entrench the political views into a specific audience that comes back every day to see what does Anderson Cooper say? What does Tucker Carlson say? The problem is we're not actually having real discussions and debates in the middle about solving the real freaking problems in our country.
Let me ask you a straight up question. A short one, then you get back.
Yeah.
Do you think Gavin Newsom's worried about you? Knows about you? Is concerned?
Oh, they know about us. Okay. We already have gotten plenty of messages from folks saying, "Hey, I work inside the campaign at Newsom, and they know about you, and they're watching you more than anyone else."
That's
it. Makes sense because guess what? They're branding this as a Republican. I just got disconnected. I think we're good. Okay. They're branding this as a Republican recall. Well, guess what happens when a Democrat comes in and starts gaining legs? All of your marketing just got shot to crap. They get screwed.
And you got a platform with a few million subscribers. And you got a platform where you're killing it every time you go live. And you got a platform where the last 12 months, every time you did a stimulus update, people are wanting to learn from you on how finance works, how Bitcoin works, how money works. We haven't even gotten into that because your next one,
there. Cheers
how
to
real
that.
Estate works. Yes. So let's do that. This
right,
is
last
team,
time I drank hard.
Player.
Last time I drank hard liquor, I got stabbed. So let's
oh
hope the rest
God.
Of today Cheers, is
toast everything.
Sorry, God. All right, let's do it again.
Now it's time to
9:50. Earliest I've had tequila since Army days. So
there you go.
Now if we get to 5,000, we'll do the second shot.
Kai, can you pull that up real quick?
Hey, Kevin, what if Newsom's camp offered to buy 15 of your points? Would you sell them to him?
No, because I don't think he can do it. I don't think he can do it.
Yeah.
I don't think he wants to do it. Because guess what? They could look at my plan right now. They wouldn't have to buy it. They could send the National Guard in tomorrow and do my first big plan.
They don't give a damn. How can they look at what's going on with homelessness continue to do what they do? It's unfathomable.
That's the bottom 10% with Jordan Peterson. That's the scary thing. I don't know how anybody does
it. It's a funnel of money, man. It's a funnel of money. They throw $5 billion at a problem with a five-year plan. $500,000 comes out the bottom to actually trying to solve things. And the rest of the money just,
that's the Rocks tequila, right?
What'd
you think?
That's Rocks tequila. Yeah. I thought it was good.
You know, I like that better than the Blanco.
I thought it was good. So, Kevin, let's do this. Audience, keep going because we haven't now gone deep. I want to go deeper. I'm going to leave it to you. Guys, if you got any questions, again, Twitter, hashtag PBD Podcast. at Patrick Bet David on Twitter. Ask the question for Kevin. We'll address some questions here with you. At around 5,000 people live here with us. We'll take the second shot. But right now we're on the first shot. So Kevin, housing, homelessness, traffic, schools. Yeah. Take a minute and explain each of them on how you're planning to address that.
Look, number one, homelessness.
Okay.
Come on, you know how much money we're losing because of tourism not coming to California, because we've got medical conventions. For example, out of Chicago, medical conventions that used to come every single year to San Francisco, they're not coming to San Francisco anymore because all they got are tents, needles, and homeless on the streets. Yeah. Guess where they're going? They're going to Vegas. We've got our businesses going to Vegas. We've got our people going to Vegas. People are coming to California to get educated. People are being born in California, both liabilities. Both are liabilities. People being born and people being educated in our state are liabilities to the state until they start producing for GDP. And that, and guess what happens when they start producing? They go, why am I paying all these taxes and this is what I'm getting instead?
Yep.
So then they leave. And COVID has accelerated that trend, which means we are beginning to cripple California. It is, California is beginning to crumble before our eyes, and it's going to get worse year after year. Now, California, in my opinion, is one of the most beautiful states. It's got some of the greatest sports teams. It is an absolutely incredible state. It has so much potential. It's just losing its edge. It's not competitive anymore. So number one, homelessness. What do? You provide compassion. Every single homeless person that's on the street, three meals a day, a bathroom, hygiene products, cleanliness, and security. These are human, basic human needs they do not have right now. That's why the rape rate, based on what a sheriff, the sheriff of the Parks Department in Los Angeles County told me, the rape rate is over 80%
for women. Let me ask you this. Is it raping other homeless people?
I mean, I have no idea exactly the specific of that one. That's a very good question. Okay. It's worth getting that fact.
It's not the why, it's the how. And there's nobody that you're ever going to meet that's going to hear you say that and be like, no, they should die on the street, Kevin.
And bingo.
No.
So here's how. The issue is coming. It's coming. So that's the first thing, okay? You got to provide basic human needs. How do you do that? Day one, state of emergency, which also, by the way, gets you FEMA funding, which makes the whole thing a lot cheaper. You deploy the National Guard, not with guns and tanks, as people think. They hear National Guard and they're like, oh my gosh, you're sending people. No, hazmat suits.
You're if sending, they're going into those encampments.
You are sending the National Guard to where homeless are. Here's food. Here's security. No more beatings. No more rapes. Here's hygiene products. How are you supposed to get a job if you are not safe and you can't get a shower and you can't even have a bathroom?
California
somewhere?
Under occupation is a tough platform to run on.
No. Not occupation. This is National Guard. Guess what? Providing service to our homeless populations for 30 days. At the same time, we build 80 emergency facilities throughout the state of California, 2,000 folks apiece. That's enough for 160,000 homeless individuals to get housing. And guess what happens in those temporary emergency facilities that we built? We have a triage system. Here's the mental health department. Here's the substance abuse department. Here's the place because you just lost your job and you just need a freaking roof. And you know what? Enough with all the madness rules like they had under the Los Angeles programs. They had the Project Room Key. Oh, you got to be in your room at 7. Come and go as you please. If you're deemed capable, you come and go as you please. You can start here. This is the social safety net that California creates. You lose your house, you can come to one of these emergency facilities. Nobody's living on the streets of California in 60 days. And guess what we're also doing? We integrate this population with our future schools so people can actually learn a career within 2 years and go make money. Because here's the thing. The poverty line is such that if you were making 30 bucks an hour, you wouldn't be in poverty. You would not be on Medi-Cal. You would not be on welfare. So if you can teach people, which is what the state should be doing, how to earn a career, become an electrician, become a plumber, whatever, become a computer scientist. These starting salaries are all $50,000 to $120,000. Let's go, California. They're nice salaries.
It sounds great. If you had businesses, if you could figure out a way, let's say tech, right?
Yes.
Like you have downtown San Francisco. We were all just there. I agree with you. I'd rather be almost anywhere else in the country than San Francisco right now. As gorgeous as that place is, it's not good.
Yeah, sir, a couple weeks ago, it's a very interesting place right now.
So what about having, instead of taxpayer money, especially federal taxpayer money for the rest of the country through FEMA to pay for these failed progressive policies, how about we institute something where Facebook, Google, these massive tech companies that are making trillions of dollars, how about you match investment? If they invest in your program, you'll give a tax write-off for them.
I think it's a phenomenal idea. In fact, one of the points on my website is being the leader for all in California. That means not just government agencies, which is usually just what Gavin Newsom does right now, Governor Newsom. What we have, what we need is a leader who's able to combine the expertise of businesses, of nonprofits, of activists, of unions, and of government agencies. I don't want anybody in California to think, oh, Kevin's coming in and he's going to do away with one person or one part or whatever. No, no, no. We need to work together as Californians.
Question for you. Question for you.
No, oh, how convenient is this? Question. The tequila, man. The tequila.
Question for you in regards to homelessness. So in L.A., there was a guy I was working with. His name was June.
You guys have air conditioning here?
He's definitely
look,
on.
I film in 65 degrees, and I guarantee you it's over 75 in here right now.
No, no. Pat wanted you to get used to the hot seat, man. Pat wanted you to get used to the hot seat.
We put it at 85 just to kind of
you're doing great.
You're doing good, man.
It's a strategy. Good.
I got three air conditioners in my office. People are like, Kevin, why are you always with a jacket? It's so I don't sweat. And you put me...
Another shot will balance that out.
Yeah, we're trying to get you to sweat that Nixon had on camera when he's debating
Yeah,
Kennedy.
Yeah. Bring it on. Let's go.
But let's go to the next one, which is homelessness. I'm in California.
We just hit that one,
I'm going to ask you a question that. Okay. So every guy named June, he had an issue with his daughter, heartbreaking issue. Mm. I felt for him on what happened. He said, every Christmas, we go to Skid Row, L.A. I said, okay, I'll join you. Yeah. So we joined him. For 8 years, every Christmas morning at 5 o'clock, we'd get up and we'd go to Skid Row. We'd take a couple hundred burgers. We would take, blankets, toothpaste, toothbrush. We'd take a bunch of things with buses and trucks. We'd go 40, 50 cars, and we'd give stuff away.
Yeah.
And I would stand there and I would talk to these homeless folks, and many times it was people who lost everything and they became homeless, right? But the question I have is, how do you get people to leave that life? Mm. How do you get them out from staying in that situation? Because if you provide a setting like that where the policy is, hey, listen, all these things happen, so we're always going to give you three meals, we have a place, we have this, maybe I'm better off just being homeless. I'd rather be homeless and you cover me with all that stuff. That's better than $36,000 of your salary. Why am I going to go get a job? It's another entitlement program that gets people to not get out. Mm. How do you get me to want to change my life?
Which, by the way, is not a hypothetical. This is a problem in New Jersey right now. They can't get people to reenter the workforce. They're making more money on unemployment.
California's got a big problem with that.
A lot of states.
This is not a hypothetical.
Yeah. Hey, look, the solution is very simple. Right now, homeless folks on the streets do not trust the government. They don't trust the agency programs that exist because you go to a food bank as a homeless person right now, you can't take the food to go. You can't take it back to your tent or whatever. And again, what happens as a result? People just don't end up going to the food banks. Millions of pounds of food get wasted over and over and over again.
Well, that's on them.
If
they're hungry and they don't go get food,
It's not just on them. It's the system. Because take a look at this. Whole Foods could feed our state's homeless population daily with the food they throw away. But guess what? They can't give it away because of liability. What happens when the National Guard comes in to take over and we take that liability as a state, which is what the government should do. That's
I'm trying
the point.
To find out
but
how we get
answer.
Them from not being
yes,
homeless.
Yes, your answer. Yeah. So first, you got to create trust. Right now, nobody trusts the government. It doesn't surprise me. That's the famous saying, oh, I'm from the government. I'm here to help. Yeah, right. Nobody believes it. So this is why
you just quoted Reagan, by the way.
Yeah, I know. You spend the first 30 days actually proving
as a joke, though. Reagan didn't say that. Reagan said that as a joke.
You provide service for the first 30 days to folks, and then we transition over to our emergency facilities. That food, that hygiene support, that's the appetizer. That's the teaser. That goes away when our emergency facilities are up.
But how do they brush their teeth if they're living in an encampment on a sidewalk and there's no running water there?
That's what the National Guard is for. You build those facilities.
I still don't know the answer. So how do we get homelessness to stop and decrease? How do you do that?
Okay, well, first of all, homelessness is different from homeless on our street. So homelessness gets stopped by actually teaching people in our schools, by actually preventing people from becoming homeless.
That's long-term,
Well, yes. Schooling, mental health, and substance abuse. These are three massive issues in the state of California. You try to get mental health support right now, 50% of therapists don't take insurance because it's a pain in the ass to deal with insurance in California. So guess what happens? The folks who do take insurance are oftentimes booked out for months. How's a homeless person with a mental health issue supposed to get an appointment 3 months out, somehow make that appointment by getting a referral from a doctor and going to this person? How are they going to get there? How are they going to be clean for that? Who's going to take them in an Uber? The Ubers reject these people. So let me answer your question. You have to deal with the existing issue and the long-term issues at the same time. This is why the 20-part plan works together. You have to build future schools, mental health facilities, and substance abuse facilities at the same time as you get people off the streets within 60 days. You do that by providing compassion, support, and care, building emergency facilities for them to go to. But nobody lives on our streets after 60 days. It's that simple. And California law says that you can live on the street if you have no alternate. Well, guess what happens when we have 160,000 spots available? We have spots available. Nobody's living on the streets.
You may have another 160,000 requests.
Yeah.
That's then the
guess
problem.
Because people will be bussing in from Kansas City.
Then guess what? We'll handle it. You know why? Because we need the people to grow our economy. If I can take...
What does that mean?
Listen, I'll tell you. If I can take another 160,000 people and I can turn...
Homeless?
I don't care who it is. I don't care if they're from a different country. I don't care. If I can take another 160,000 people and I can teach them how to... earn a living wage without being on welfare, without being on Medi-Cal, and they can go work for Apple and Facebook and Google or local companies like Patagonia or Amgen. I don't care. If I can teach them the skills they need, I grow our GDP and they stay rather than leave.
Well, yeah, but isn't the idea like, you know, the Ellis Island, you would go to the island, you're an immigrant. Hey, what do you bring to the table? I'm a sewer. I'm a person who knows how to, you know, cook. I'm a guy that's good with shoes. I'm a guy that's whatever, right? I'm construction. I'm this.
Mm-hmm.
To say, I'll take anybody, that's like a corporation saying, I'm Google. I'll take anybody. Send me any talent.
We're not a corporation. The government is not a corporation. The government's role is to make sure that people are capable. The government has failed that role for the last 40 years. The government has led people through a college system.
Yeah, but the government, like for example, I'll give you an idea. So one problem, immigration, that's a problem here. That's my opinion.
Immigration is a huge problem. Well, why do we only get refugees? Why don't we get licensed architects and licensed professionals coming from Brazil to America? Why not?
Because it's hard.
You gotta have attorneys, lotteries. Listen to this. Look, real quick, and then your thing. I've got somebody I want to hire from New Zealand. I want to hire them. I want to provide them a job. Yeah. They have good skills. They called three attorneys. All three attorneys go, too complicated, won't even take the case. We're willing to throw tens of thousands of dollars at it, won't even take the case because the legal immigration system is broken. Why do we have a border wall issue? It's because the legal immigration system is garbage.
So go back to it. So go back to the same thing. So for example, you get how many tens of thousands of kids come here? They go to our educational system. They go through our great universities, our great schools, and then they get the four-year degree. And what do? Go back to Brazil. They go back to their country rather than keeping them.
Yeah.
But the idea is to bring the best talent to California or your state or your country. For you to say, I'll take any 160,000, well, guess what? The mayor of Chicago would love to send you 10,000 people on a Greyhound bus to you for you to handle the cost of what it takes to take care of them at $60 a pop.
You just invited a bunch of people.
Why do you think FEMA comes in to help when we issue a state of emergency too? This is not just a Californian problem, homelessness. It's an American problem.
No question.
It's an American problem.
But California's leading it.
Fine. The policies on this website, meetkevin.com, those policies are not just Californian policies, there are American priorities. These should be simple, clear, reasonable priorities in our country. We got to start somewhere.
Don't they have a little bit of a responsibility, as Joe Rogan said, to figure their life out a little? I mean, is all 160,000, we'll come take care of you? Because I'm a California resident. Yeah. I live in L.A.
Yeah.
Homelessness to me is probably 1A, as far as the factors in the country, because it affects me in the state. And if they start rolling into where I live, I think that's my exit package. As a voter, when will you get them off the streets?
60 days.
All
of them. It's a state of emergency. Day one, National Guard's there. You get a 5-week transition period when you become governor. I've only got 1 year to prove myself, and then people have to re-vote me in or vote me out. So if I can't fulfill my promise within 60 days, that'd be pretty bad for my re-election purposes. So it's going to happen within 60 days. all of them off of our streets.
I see people that put tents up in front of, you know, restaurants and on sidewalks and bus stops, just thinking these guys don't want to get a job.
They'll
inconvenience anybody they can.
But let's also understand homelessness for a moment. When the people who become homeless, about 15% have mental health issues. About 15% have drug problems or substance abuse problems.
Okay.
The vast majority of people who become homeless for economic reasons. Housing's too expensive. They get evicted. They lose their job. COVID happens and they lose their job. Whatever. And guess what? Statistically, as much as you're talking about people coming in with buses or whatever, the statistics show that most homeless come from within California.
Sure.
92% of the homeless in San Francisco come from within California. Because
you haven't incentivized you haven't incentivized them to come from externally.
Just real quick, if you don't mind.
I just to push back on it, because it sounds, it's altruistic in nature and it sounds great, right? But it sounds like your policy position here, anybody that's dealt with anybody that knows anything about mental health or drug addiction, 60 days is not enough.
No, I didn't say
that. It sounds to me, to my ear, all right, and again, it's an altruistic position that you're presenting it as, but it sounds to me like your policy is to have the National Guard come in and detain the homeless.
To have the
Army come in and arrest the homeless.
This is clickbait.
So Tom Zenner doesn't have to step over somebody on his way to Target.
Clickbait.
Is that not what it sounds like? Am I wrong here?
I think you missed it. Rainbow colored handcuffs are
still handcuffs.
I think you need another shot of tequila, because then you'd pay attention to what I said.
What I said was
number one, the National Guard gets deployed to provide compassion and support. We're not detaining people.
Compassionate handcuffs.
No. Remember how I said people are not rolling out with guns? This is the National Guard providing a service. Now, you mentioned...
At the expense of the American taxpayer as well.
Well, what do you think government's for? Government is for providing services for people. They're failing at it now. They're wasting. We got enough money, but the money's being squandered right now because we've got a failed leader running the state of California with horrible policies. The money's there. So don't worry about the money. But I want to make this clear. You mentioned, Kevin, you're not going to solve mental health in 60 days. Duh. I know that. That's why I said we got to build those mental health facilities. It's going to take years to solve our schooling and mental health problem. I understand that. I said we have no more homeless on our streets within 60 days by showing trust and compassion and showing better opportunities. Because guess what happens? When we get to our emergency facilities, we actually have clean facilities where people live.
Let's go to the next one. So there's a bit of a, I think you gotta tighten the argument there with that. I think homelessness has some leaks, and I think the way I'm still...
How would you tighten it? Let's hear it.
Yeah, no, my concern is for you to figure out a way to get them out. My concern is how to get them out. Like, think about how...
No, nobody's even trying.
A reentry program?
What I'm saying is, look...
Sheriff of L.A. saw my policy and said, we need a state of emergency in our county. Yeah. The sheriff of L.A. is copying my policy.
Started taking people away.
I get that. By the way, that's a part of what Mayor Giuliani did in the streets of New York. That was one of the methods that he did. So I actually like the direction he's going. The only concern I have is when you incentivize somebody to say, here's what I'm going to give you without a deadline to get you off. So, for example, if you go that route and you give me a deadline, I'm going to give you this for 60 days. Like, okay, I'll give you an idea. So one of my guys smokes a lot of weed, a ton of weed. One of my best friends. We worked at Burger King together. The guy's always high, loves weed. He's one of the funniest guys. I love this guy. He let me live at his house for 18 days when I got out of jail. I had no place to live. I love this guy. I mean, this is one of my favorite people in the world. But he smokes a shitload of weed. He's always high, right?
Tom Zenner.
Me and Snoop.
No, but one time I'm sitting down with him, and we start talking about entitlement programs. Yeah, so welfare, right? We're giving you welfare. Mm. I said, look, I don't mind giving welfare. Yeah. Let's give food stamps. It's fine. But here's what I want to do. Every month, I want to drug test you. He says, that's unfair. I said, why is that unfair? The government is supporting you. Let's drug test you every month. I don't think that's fair. You're invading people's privacy. So wait a minute. When I was in the Army and the Army's paying my bills, which is paid by taxpayers, the Army can say whatever the hell they want to do with me because taxpayers are paying for me. So every month on Mondays, here's what would happen. Formation. If your social starts, last 4 year social start, no joke. If your last 4 year social starts with number 3, step up. And we would step out. Come on, drug test. They would go your hand, because the formula is all you need to do is you need to put a little bit of, Clorox. So everybody would have a little bit of a small little vial. So if you put Clorox on your hands and you pee on your fingers, then you're going to come on naked.
This is the value people are looking for in Valuetainment. This is Valuetainment. Where were you when I was in the minor leagues, bro? My God.
Game changer today, right? All because of Meet Kevin. So watch this. So watch what happens.
David's like, you guys didn't know that? Everybody knows that.
Yeah. So
I'm on a delay. Say that again.
Don't worry about it. That's all part of the delay. But so we go there. And by the way, this is how you had to pee. You had to pee. No joke. You had to pee. They would tell you, give me, hold the cup, and the guy stands right here, and you would bring it. You can't touch anything, and you had to pee in it. Then you give it to him. So they wouldn't even let us do anything, right? And then I would say, oh, boom, you're smoking weed. Article 87, boom, you come out here, you're going to go do
down.
This. So what I'm saying is the following. Let's give you the benefit program. Mm. With one caveat. Mm-hmm. What's the caveat? I'll give you 90 days, but every other week I'm drug testing you. If you come out positive, whatever the timeline you put in there, right? If you come out negative, I'll give it to you for another 90 days or 60 days. Because you're right, we got to stop the drug system, mm-hmm. and the people, there's a real issue. So yes, I will feed you 3 meals a day. Yes, mm-hmm. I'll give you a place to live if you are willing to go without drugs for 2 months. Okay, mm-hmm. that's number one. The other one is, you have 90 days to go get a job. So meaning is the following. This is my response back to yours. Because mm-hmm. I kind of like what you're doing, and I truly want to support you. Like, if we have you here, this is a form of a support. You have to understand, mm-hmm. we don't have everybody else here. So the other part will be the following. Mm. Let's just say, what is 3 meals a day and a place to stay at and all the other costs? What is that worth per month? Give me a number. What is that worth per month?
Per individual, for
per
example?
Individual, yeah. What is it worth? Is it $2,000 a month? $3,000 a month?
It should be
more
much,
than that. No.
Well, here, look.
Give me a number.
Here's the thing. San Francisco right now is spending $5,000 a month on tents. It's ridiculous because it's not systematized. There's
per
no
person?
Per person.
Yeah. $5,000 a month?
It's stupid.
Per tent?
It's stupid. Yeah. It's stupid. And here's why. There's no scale.
Yeah.
Guess what happens when you come in as the governor and you work with businesses and nonprofits, nonprofits donating food, your costs go way down.
You guys
down.
Not have last shop in California? Like, a tent's like $150.
I don't want, no. They already got their tents. They already have their tents, okay?
I'll give you an idea.
The tents are already there.
I'll
listen,
give you an idea.
It's got to be under $500 a month, and we will do whatever we can to get that scale down. I want to run it like
meals
an efficient
a day.
Business.
If you do 3 meals a day,
stuff from Whole Foods that they're throwing away and they donate?
If you get them to do it.
Oh, we are working together in the state. But remember what I said.
Kevin,
my plans.
Let's just say it's $2,000 a month.
It's not going to be $2,000 a month. But
let's just say it's
$1,500
a month.
No. If you want to run with a number, go with 1,000. There, that's easy.
Okay,
enough.
Let's say 1,000 a month. Pick any number. Stay with me here.
Uh-huh.
Say it's 1,000 a month.
Mm-hmm. That's $160,000 a month for the homeless.
Yeah, so I'm going to get, it's not $160,000 a month. It's 160 times 1,000. That's mm-hmm. not $160,000 a month. Just take it up a lot more. You got to add three zeros to it.
Yeah, no, you're right.
Yeah,
you're
so you're off a little
bit. He doesn't operate in anything under two commas anyway.
It's right. 160,000 people is what I meant.
That's right. Times $1,000 a month.
You're correct. Yes.
So now let's look at this. If I'm going to give you $1,000 a month, let's
divide. It's too much.
What's the minimum wage in California?
Minimum wage,
15,
well,
right?
Well, it's going to 15. Yeah. It keeps fluctuating.
Give me the number today. Is it 1040?
Yeah, somewhere around there.
It depends on the
because
city.
Because it goes
in
up.
In the cities, it's 15.
Pull up California minimum wage. Just pull up California, because you're going to see what direction I'm going with this year. This is how I'm willing to agree to take care of you. Mm. What's minimum wage in California? Yeah. California minimum wage. Hang on, let me just make my point.
I got a response to you.
You will get it. Let me just give it to you.
I know where you're going.
So $15 an hour. So watch this. $1,000, 66, right? I'll give you 3 square meals. I'll give you a place to stay at, but you have to do community service 70 hours a month, 20 hours a week. I'll give it to you.
Mm-hmm.
But hey, Mr. Homeless, we got to get you back working, and working's very healthy for you. You want to have a place to stay at? You got to work 70 hours a month. Mm. If you don't do it, I'm not taking care of you. So I'm mentally getting you to realize, holy shit, I'm doing stupid work, cleaning the sides of the street. I don't want to do this anymore. I'm going to go get a real job.
Mm-hmm.
Now we're talking, because I'm drug testing you on a monthly basis. I'm going to get you off the drugs. I'm going to get you back to the habit of working. 90 days later, now go back to regular life. Go get a job for yourself.
Yeah. Look, what you've just described is a beautiful utopian example. The reality is, the issues that have occurred on our streets have made this a much larger and more complicated issue. The folks who have been living on our streets for years.
I think
you're
pitching utopian.
No.
You're giving free money and saying, give me another 160,000 people. That's utopia.
No.
We have free money to throw at people.
Wrong.
That's what you're saying.
Wrong. Okay, the person who's throwing away free money is forgiving criminal traffic tickets and putting us another $12 billion into debt. Okay, so we can play numbers all day long, but the reality is, You've got to get homeless off our streets, and you have to rehabilitate. You can't take a person.
Your plan's not going to do that.
No. It does, because I mentioned in my emergency facilities, yeah. We have a mental health facility, substance abuse facility, and educational support via our future schools. We need people. Look, the end goal is people who have careers, who are not on Medi-Cal, yeah. Who are not on welfare. That's the end goal. So how do you get to the end goal? People cleaning the streets? No, guess who's cleaning our streets under my plan? The people who are nonviolent prisoners who are going to go, they're going to be cleaning our streets. So we can talk more about that, but that's another piece of our plan.
So go back and break down what I just proposed to you and tell me how that's utopia.
Your vision right now
yes.
Is that people can go from where they're living now in their tent to cleaning the streets yeah. for 70 hours a month and then going into a real job.
God forbid somebody works 15 hours a week. Catastrophic if they do that.
I'm not disagreeing with your argument.
Yeah.
But I'm also being a realist. I understand.
People work 40 a week. I'm saying 15 a week.
I got to be honest, Pat. I actually got to push back on you on this, because yeah. I don't think it's utopian. I think it's totalitarian. I don't like that. And I understand your perspective and why.
Don't take the money.
I hear you.
Then
but
don't take the money.
You're on the
this is
then
this
you're
is
on
the
street,
thing.
Is the problem.
Now, Kevin, I genuinely feel your passion, and that's something I hope is coming through. And I've sat with a lot of politicians, mm-hmm. and they're not as passionate as you. I genuinely feel that, and that's something to be commended. So much so, I hope you lose, so you end up in the private sector where you can actually do something. But the real thing here, Pat, is that these people that end up in control of these programs, these bureaucrats, are evil. They are either greedy or they're crazy. And if you incentivize them to trade basic needs for labor, you're going to run into a really, really bad situation. That is essentially communism. That is essentially slavery. Why do I hate communism? Because communism trades personal autonomy for basic needs.
Let me ask you a question. So if that's communism, what do you define? I'm going to give you a place to live and give you food and give you all that for free in return for nothing. So what do you call that?
Well, what I call that is I call that a social program.
In return for you not changing any area of your life that's hurting the
economy.
It's a social ramp up. I agree that there should be.
What's the ramp up, though? I got nothing. No skin in the game.
There should be some ramp up.
Where is the skin in the game?
I totally understand what you're saying. I don't have the answer for it. I'm not running for governor of California. I need to. I'll think about
it
more.
Here's the thing. I'll give you an answer.
But the thing, real quick. That is essentially, that is my entire issue with communism. My entire issue with communism is it's glorified slavery. You are trading your personal autonomy. You're trading your personal autonomy for your basic needs met. Do you have how?
What do you
think
of
a slave?
Military? So military is communism?
No, you chose to do it. You chose to go into the military.
You chose.
If there was a draft, it would be. If there was a draft, it's the personal autonomy. It's the choice.
Wait a minute. I'm giving you a choice. You don't have to take the food. You don't have to take a place to live.
Okay, here. That's
not choice. Don't take it.
With all due respect, if the National Guard's coming by sweeping the streets, what am I going
to
do?
I never said National Guard. Well, that's his. What I'm saying to you is, if you want this,
yeah.
No problem. It's kind of like if you want a job. If you want a job, I'll give you a job. But you got to work 40 hours
happening.
A week.
Look
this
what's
is
happening
a benefits
with
an exchange.
Look what's happening with the prison industry. The prison industry incentivizes small crimes, people doing extensive amount of time for small crimes because it's cheap labor. For-profit prisons incentivize the entrapment of individuals, right?
You guys are going down the rabbit hole.
Meanwhile, Kevin's cutting a YouTube video.
Dude, I understand the perspective because you know the value of hard work. There's some people.
I know the value of skin in a game.
You got to look at the other side. You've got to look at a bureaucrat that's looking for free labor.
So let me ask you a question. Upbringing, what kind of a community you lived in? A family. Were you middle income? Were you upper class?
Well,
mom
gosh,
and dad,
we
what did your
lost
parents
our
do?
Home near to foreclosure when I was 9
What'd
years old.
What did your parents
old. Do? My mom, not much. Worked at Build-A-Bear for a few months. Odd jobs here and there, minimum wage. Father had a carpentry business that he started, went bankrupt in 2002, and tried clawing himself back, working a W-2 job at $50,000 a year.
Did you guys live in apartments or a house?
Townhouse.
Okay.
Apartments and then a townhouse.
And a townhouse. Mm-hmm. Okay, so middle income class, middle, upper class?
Like low middle.
Low
if
middle.
Anything.
Okay, did you go private or did you go public school?
All public school.
Are you public school?
Well, with
public
the exception school, of my first like year. When
that doesn't count. I'm talking. You went public.
Yeah,
Are you public?
School, K through college.
Public. So we're all public here.
Private college.
Parents stayed together. Your parents stayed together.
Irish Catholic. Then none of them died. So
your parents married still today.
Divorced at six.
Parents stayed together.
Yeah.
Okay. So for me, our parents got a divorce. I was 10 when I sought a divorce. When that happens, you know how it works. It's a pretty complicated situation for a kid when you're going through it, right? Okay. So Did people see you doing anything big in your life when you were 12 years old? No, no, to be honest, were people saying this guy's going to take over the world?
Not that I'm aware of.
Were you a person that this guy's going to go probably kill it in
Look,
life?
I was no valedictorian. I was like I was the person who was looking up my next strategy for Halo and Splinter Cell in the back of the class. Okay.
My idea has always been to get people off of needing help. Programs to be independent.
Yes, yes.
The more you make people independent, their confidence goes up. Okay. Yeah. Mm. Look at Kevin's confidence today. Go look at Kevin's first video. Look at Kevin's video today. Look what's happened to Kevin. I followed Kevin from, you know, you sent me a message years ago on Valuetainment. I don't know what it was. And I think.
You didn't reply to me.
Did I? Seriously, I don't reply to you?
The one probably not years ago, maybe recently you did.
Yeah, but I said I've been following your stuff for the last few years.
Yes, and recently, this is true.
Yeah, I really like your workout. I really like where you're going. But here's what you're doing. Mm. You're officially a business model. Folks, I don't know if you know or not, this guy made $6 million last year. It's not like you made $100,000 last year. You didn't make $200,000. He's a 20-some-year-old making $6.2 million last year. 29, but you're in your 20s, making $6-point-something million last year, okay? So it's not like you're not a success story. I want those models to be shared. So to go back to yours. You want to be able to get all that incentive? Mm-hmm. Skin in the game. I give you the choice to say no to it. Say no to it. No problem. Mm. So by the way, FYI, pushback, go with tiers. Here's the tiers.
Okay.
First tiers. I'll give it 30 days, no skin in the game.
Yeah.
30 days.
Let me
zero
push back here because we've been on this one for
that.
Like eight minutes on
it. It's not that I see your methodology and I agree with it on a certain level. What I don't think you're accounting for is just how bad some of these politicians are, and just
we're on the same page there.
So the bureaucracy. I do not want to incentivise these bureaucrats.
Pat, I'll take one for
I do not want to incentivise the bureaucrats to.
I got mine.
See,
let me jump in, okay?
I can see somebody like Bill de Blasio increasing homelessness specifically so he can get free labor.
So then what you're talking about is you're calling. Okay, let's get away from homelessness.
No. Wait. You guys had your 8 minutes, okay? hold on a second here.
Shout out to Adam Sauce monologue.
Yeah. Here's your solution, okay? Listen, Patrick, what you're describing is force, control, retirements. You're saying take it or leave it. Guess what? That's what we have now. We got minimum wage, take it or leave it. And guess what people are doing? They're leaving it and they're on the streets. They're dying on our streets because the government isn't providing support. So what do you do that's different that no governor has done before but should do? They should be ethically obligated to do this day one. Help, educate, trust.
Occupy.
And guess, stop.
Those are general statements you're making. I want specifics.
No, I just gave you a lot of specifics.
Not a lot of specifics. Hold on.
Ideas. No. What is building 2,000 emergency or 80 emergency facilities with 2,000 people in each facility is not this utopian idealism, okay? These are emergency facilities. Let me get to the bottom line.
We got unicorns flying. California.
Aristotle says the end is what matters. And the end is creating independence. Can we agree that the end is creating independence where people are not relying on welfare and entitlement programs? Is that not what you would describe?
Absolutely.
Thank
is.
You. Okay, so we agree on creating
not
independence is the bottom
everybody
line.
Everybody is going
to
be able to
get
there.
Hold on, man. I'm about to make you take another shot, and I'm going to give you a third one after that, okay? So we got to create independence. Number one.
A good time.
Okay, give me 30 more seconds. Create independence. You do that. Not by people dying on our streets. When more people are dying on our streets to homelessness than gun violence, you know you have a problem. Give this a try. You get 60 days, National Guard, help, educate, trust. Then we have emergency facilities where we deal with the drug problems that you're talking about. We deal with the mental health problems. We educate and we create the independence by giving people an opportunity. What opportunity do you have today? As a 25-year-old, as a 35-year-old, as a 45-year-old, what opportunity do you have today to go get a career? You're going to come up with the 10 grand, 20, 30 grand to go to boot camp? You're going to come up with the money to go pay for your way through a community college? There's no way for you to get started. You want to try to get a minimum wage job? Good luck even getting an Uber to drive you there when you haven't had a shower in weeks. You start with help, education, trust. You create independence.
Okay, good. So let's go to housing.
Great.
What's your solution with housing?
Solution with housing is the government is not incentivizing the building of enough houses. It's very simple. It's supply-demand economics. The government doesn't need to be in the way of creating all these unique special policies to try to make housing more affordable. We need more houses. And then you have more affordable housing. It's very simple. You could do that by building new communities.
Multifamily units.
It doesn't matter what. It could be single family. It could be multifamily. My vision is you legalize gambling. You build Las Vegas-style strips around California with housing communities around those powered by solar farms and wind farms, which are very hard today to integrate to our existing ecosystem because nobody wants to build the transmission lines. But you can build transmission lines when you have new highways going to new communities. You build 500,000 homes a year versus the 80,000 homes we build now. Now, people are, well, 500,000 homes, that's a lot. A lot of folks don't know the scope of California, though. We have 482 cities in California. That works out to a little over 1,000 homes on average per city. It's doable. It's possible. And we could do that by streamlining the government processes so we can have new communities, more housing, and then we have choices for people to move to more affordable homes and better transportation to get them to
the rents them or the state sells them?
No. The state just simplifies the building and safety process. You can actually raise the standard a little bit. Have one standard throughout the entire state of California rather than 482 different governments basically saying, well, we want this. Make it very simple. State of emergency, the governor takes control of the building and safety department. Everything is under the sole power of the state.
He is a Democrat. I just realized.
Holy moly.
Now I know why you're running
He's running for dictator of California. Everything's a state of emergency.
Do it my way. Take your shot right now.
It's a state of emergency. Take your shot.
God. You know what is a state of emergency? A state of emergency is the unaffordable rent prices and home prices we have in our state. Why is it unaffordable? Because we need 300,000 homes a year to stay even.
Yeah.
We're building 80,000 homes. You know what the median home price is? You want to hear dictatorship? Median home price, $800,000. That's dictatorship. How is somebody going to get started building wealth in California when those are the median home prices? Are you kidding me?
What's the occupancy rate right now?
The occupancy rate? Look around at the vacancies that we have in commercial. Every city's different, but we've got vacant commercial buildings, office buildings that aren't being used. We can redevelop these to multifamily housing, but we need to expedite that. You can't expedite that when every city is fighting with every county. Why is
That's a great point. Is California too big? Should it be broken up?
No, it's not a size issue. It's a leadership issue. Why is it that the sheriff of L.A. is fighting the mayor of L.A. and they're both going, well, I mean, we can't do it because of these rules and this. You need somebody at the top who goes, we need reasonable policies. We have to address our states of emergency to benefit all Californians. We can do that by raising standards, but having one standard rather than nearly 500 standards. That's how you build more homes in California. That's how you create affordable housing.
You guys all live in California. Yeah. I didn't. So is the lifestyle the same in Sacramento as it is in LA?
Not even close.
Is the cost of living the same? So to that point, would one standardization throughout the state, is it a one size fits all state?
Well, here, let me tell you what's a crime right now. California licenses architects and engineers. We know that. You want to be an architect engineer, you got to get licensed. They verify that you have E&O, you have liability insurance, you have workers' comp. But guess what those architects, engineers, and contractors can't do? They can't help you get started on your project until you wait for months to get building approval. And I'm not saying do away with building inspections. We got to have building inspections. We got to have audits. But we got to streamline the entire process because right now we have more homes sitting vacant sometimes for years that could be providing homes. We have enough. We don't even have to build 500,000 homes. If we just streamlined our existing building and safety standards.
You're an interesting cat, man.
We have 17 really more are. Points, by
I
the way.
I got solutions.
Go to the next one. Go
solutions.
Traffic. Fix the traffic on the 405.
Let's go.
How are you going to do it?
What you need is very simple. You need optional toll roads. Optional toll roads. Why do I say optional? Because you don't want to regressively tax individuals who are now forced to take a toll road. So you have optional toll roads. For example, you've got tight areas between, let's say, the 101, around the 101 interchange and the 405. You have horrible traffic. What do? You build optional tunnels, 6-lane variable direction tunnels underneath those directions of travel. So when rush hour is going one way, all 6 tunnels are going that way, and they're paid toll roads, which then profit the business who builds them under obviously, making sure it's safe and the government's involved in partnership with this. You partner, and the state takes a cut of the toll road revenue to where you're actually building free additional roads for the state, that's making money for the state, but you're charging for those optional roads. So the people who wanna go commute faster, they can pay a buck or whatever it might be for their transit.
Let me ask you a question.
Roads.
If you were able to push through some of these big things like toll roads and tunnels and everything like that, and then you were no longer the governor, do the projects have to continue? Are they already funded and taken care of, and they're gonna happen regardless? Or if you're not the governor in 3 years, could it be gone?
Well, this is why it's very, very important that our first year gets off going very strongly, because we want Californians to see this is the change we want. We solved homelessness. Could you imagine we just solved homelessness within the first year? That would be a win, because nobody's been able to do that before. The last 17 years, homelessness has gone sky high. And guess who's been in power for the last 17 years in California? Gavin Newsom. So the problem is our existing leadership and our existing government. We need solutions that make sense to Californians. When solutions make sense to Californians and we start implementing those, Californians will demand those continue.
Okay, last one, schools. Let's address that one. How are you going to fix the education?
Future schools. So here's what I believe. I believe that humans are entitled to, by 18, graduating debt-free and with the opportunity to get a career. That's what I believe. But what do our high schools teach today? They teach you geography and geometry. You graduate high school, what happens? Maybe you get a minimum wage job, or you go hundreds of thousands of dollars into student debt. That is not how to lead a life. That is how to stay poor. That is how to stay broke, especially in a state where there's high homelessness, happiness levels go down, and it's difficult to get around because traffic is so problematic, and it's difficult to build wealth because housing is so expensive. Now, don't get me wrong. California is beautiful, and California has so much potential. We've got really smart people in California. The leadership is broken, and by solving the leadership at our schools in partnership with our unions, our school unions, we can make schooling better. Teachers are miserable teaching the same boring curriculum, seeing their students graduate at 18, turning homeless or not able to get a job or working two or three minimum wage jobs. And then they have a child. And then guess what? Now they're working two or three minimum wage jobs and they're in poverty and they're on social services. That is not what California should be fostering. That's exactly what California is doing. We should be providing careers for people, because guess what happens? You have a career and you provide lots of value to a business because you have a skill. Well, then maybe you can get maternity leave. And you're not relying on the government. The point is, get people off reliant on the government. We got to get government out of people's lives.
Okay, so that one, I get it. We want people to get off of government. Should we fire terrible teachers, or should we keep them keep tenure going?
Well, I mean, okay. So this, I think that goes into a very nuanced discussion as well. But I think I just want to make this point here. I think we are on the same wavelength of we want to get the government out of people's lives. We want people not to be dependent on the government. But the way you get there is by actually instituting real change. And you do that with our homeless plan. You do that with our future
schools. Well, we want another 160,000 homeless people.
I didn't say that.
The government out of your life is by letting the government have a state of emergency and take everything over.
All right, so let me ask you, candidates running against you.
No. Are you saying that homelessness is not a state of emergency? Are you saying that housing is not?
It's about time you went on the offensive. Good job. But the idea and that you're appealing to my libertarian nature by talking about regulation, the way bureaucracy has stranglehold over commerce. Okay, these are all accurate things. Mm-hmm. These are things that it's refreshing, frankly, to hear a Democrat admit that this is true.
Yeah.
But then you kowtow to the unions as if they're not a bureaucracy that's harming the educational process as well. And also, we're talking about building new homes, and we're not talking about the government disincentive to build new homes, because right now it's free money for Section 8. The reason that new homes aren't being made is that you have these commercial real estate, these buy zoning. The reason why every city in America looks the same now is because of government, guys. The reason why there's shops on the first floor and then apartments on the next four floors is because of government. This is how you maximize real estate.
I go to downtown Europe. I love that. I love having a coffee shop downtown and people are able to live above. What's wrong with that?
What do you mean? I didn't say there's anything wrong with it. You're saying that you're going to build more houses. There's a disincentive to build houses because if you have Patrick, right, and Patrick's going to invest $100 million into a place, he's not going to invest in old school baby boomer, you know, widespread suburbia. Mm. It's not going to be urban sprawl. It's going to be a commercial section on the bottom, and then it's going to be three floors of Section 8, and then three floors that you can put out into a REIT at $3,000 a month, and they stay vacant the whole time, and he's going to make five times his money.
I get where you're coming from. I do think a lot of government programs create issues in housing, such as rent control. And I'm not proposing get rid of rent control, but I understand that rent control actually disincentivizes available units on the market. And so there are some issues where rent control can actually increase rents. But we don't need to talk about rent control. What we need to focus on is more options for folks. And guess what's happening right now? Because it's so hard to go through the building and safety processes, you come into California with $100 million, you want to build, I don't know, 20, 30 homes or something like that, or you want to build 100 homes, whatever you can build with your budget. You are incentivized in California to build mansions. Why? Because when you can build a house for $2 million and you could sell it for $5 million, it pays for all the headache and nonsense you went to for 2 or 3 years dealing with the architects and the building and the bureaucrats and the regulation. We're not incentivizing actually building smaller, lower-end units because it's so impossible and then it's not profitable.
Yeah.
So it's actually, I mean, like, look, we're on the same wavelength. I just believe that these programs are coming in making folks less interested in providing the homes.
So teachers, fire bad teachers, yep, or keep good teachers? What do we do with bad teachers?
I need to understand that a lot more, okay, what you're asking me, because I do not have all of the answers and statistics for you on that. I personally believe that if you suck at your job, you should not be working that job.
Right. Well, your biggest battle is the teachers union, and that's where you got to get
saying.
Your hands.
That's what's wrong with
that.
Yeah.
I don't believe that I am anti-teachers union. I believe that I am for a combination of businesses working with unions and nonprofits to provide better education. We could do that together under the leadership of a government.
Okay, fair enough. So I got a question here for you from Prince. Kai, if you want to go on Twitter, Prince on Yahoo. Prince asked question on Twitter. Hey, meet Kevin. I was considering relocating to California for a job in tech, but tech companies are expanding or moving to Texas. Yeah. I live in Dallas. How would you recruit me to your state as a governor?
Good question.
Great question. Yeah.
Well, the first thing that we need is businesses staying. We've lost Coinbase. We've got a Tesla Gigafactory going to Florida. Businesses are leaving in droves. Their headquarters are moving out. Hewlett Packard moved out. They're endless businesses. Hey,
where did Valuetainment and PHP start?
California, both of them.
Where'd they go to?
Texas and Florida.
Well, I interviewed, for example, an HVAC, one of my HVAC salesperson, and he's saying he's losing his employees.
That's not the question,
to other states.
It's Prince.
Yeah. Well, so the answer is, how do you get businesses to stay? First of all, you get businesses to stay with proper, reasonable regulation, not this overbearing regulation that we have now. We need to lower income taxes for everyone. That's very key. No income taxes under the first $250,000 is a pay raise for everyone in California.
Can you do that?
It has to be done with the legislature.
Okay.
Yeah. So that's.
By the way, you do that. That's a very big thing if you're able to.
That makes California competitive.
Of course it does.
Exactly. Because right now we're not.
How do you pass that with the massive budget that you have for the state? All these social programs, you want to cut taxes for people under a quarter of a million?
Oh, yeah.
That's rough.
Because here's why. Most of the taxes, somewhere around, the vast majority of our taxes are paid by people making over $250,000. That's where the vast majority of our taxes come from.
Absolutely. Do you actually know the numbers?
So right now, if we had, if we instituted my plan and we had no taxes on the first $250,000, we would generate a little over 60% of our revenue from the people over $250,000 under the current tax regime. But here's what we need. When we legalize gambling, when we have toll roads, when we reduce welfare costs, when we reduce community college and high school costs by combining community colleges and high schools into future schools, what are you doing? You're going through every layer of government. You're getting folks off of social services by giving them more income. You're creating more opportunities to spend. You're building more houses, which is more tax revenue. You are growing the economy to where over time, you do not need as many tax revenues.
One of the most reasonable Democrats that I've heard in a long time.
Let's go.
Outside of the whole Occupy My State, I want to own thing.
Stop.
It's really very reasonable.
Thank you. All right. I don't know what your opposition is to stopping people dying on our streets.
Hey, are there going to be any debates?
I hope so. You know, right now, guess who controls the election date? The governor's office.
Oof.
So the date isn't even set.
The date's not even set.
Oh, it'll be the day before the lockdown or something, right?
Yeah. However they want.
If any state ever did need a state of emergency, if any state ever did.
It's California. California. Did you hear about the lawsuit?
How do you feel about Caitlyn Jenner running? With her policies.
Come on. Any Republican running is not going to make anything happen in the state. First of all, you go through the policies of the other candidates.
Yeah.
Nobody has a plan. Nobody has a plan that I found. There are generic things.
Can
about
you pull up Caitlyn Jenner's plan?
Less red tape, or okay, maybe we should deal with the homelessness because the person outside the airport hangar is homeless, says Caitlyn Jenner. Where's the real plan? We need real action. Now, I don't really care about the other candidates because I don't believe they're my competition. My competition is Governor Newsom, who is screwing this state with his policies.
I don't think he is because I think people have accepted the fact that this is not a good governor for the state of California. I think people have finally got to a point where they're by the way,
can
left
he be
and right.
recalled and win?
No. If he's recalled, no, he's
nobody.
Out.
He's out. No. Mm. So that's what I'm saying. I don't think he's your competition. I think the state of California is. I think your competition is John Cox. It's
Mr.
Kevin
Mayor.
Faulkner. It's Jenner. Wow. It's Doug Ose. You know, you got a few of these guys. Obviously, Major Williams. Some of these other guys that are coming up that are, you know, potentially making a little name for themselves. But that's really the people you're looking at.
I don't believe it. I respectfully disagree.
You think Newsom is your competition?
100%. If Newsom gets recalled, we win. Newsom's got to go. We need people to say yes on recall.
Newsom gets recalled, you win.
That's right.
So you're saying if the X amount votes for the recall on the election?
I'm sorry, I missed
the recall election is happening. It's 100%.
It's happening, but the date hasn't been set because the governor's office gets to determine that. Meanwhile, they're suing their own administration for a law that they signed into law, calling their own law.
It's Sunday on July 4th, 6 o'clock at night.
It's ridiculous. It's ridiculous.
And buses will be provided for all his supporters, by the way.
Have you had any debates yet? Has there been any debates with anybody yet?
No,
zero debates yet.
I will debate any of them.
You know, and this got you ready, man. This is a good little prep.
You guys are easy.
Yeah,
bring it on.
I don't know if the audience is saying that, but that's good for you to know. That's good.
We can do. Patrick's got a whole production house here. We can get an animated Gavin Newsom and an animated Caitlyn Jenner. And we can have the whole debate.
Why don't we talk about another topic here? Go to about valedictorians. Let's just kind of get an opinion. I mean, Kevin's got strong opinions about a lot of different things. Here's a CNBC story. This is why class valedictorians don't become millionaires. Everyone remembers their class valedictorian. Perfect grades, perfect test scores, and in some cases, perfect hair. They probably went on to professional fame and enormous wealth, right? Not necessarily. In his new book, Eric Barker explores the maxims we use to discuss success. He finds a valedictorian rarely becomes standout successes. His assessments are based on research by Karen Arnold, a professor at Boston College and the authors of Lives of Promise. What becomes of high school valedictorians? She tracked 81 high school. This is pretty interesting. She tracks 81 high school valedictorians after graduation. She writes, there was little debate that high school success predicted college success. Nearly 90% are now in professional careers with 40% in highest tier jobs. They are reliable, consistent, and well-adjusted. By all measures, the majority have good lives, but how many of them are number one high school performers, go on to change the world, run the world, or impress the world? The answer seems to be clear. You know what the answer is? Zero. Not one, not five, zero. It seems that the traits that set one up for exceptional success in high school and college, self-discipline, you know, and the ability to comply with rules, are not the same traits that lead individuals to start disruptive companies or make shocking breakthroughs. Valedictorians aren't likely to be the future visionaries, says Arnold. They typically settle into the system instead of shaking things up. What are your thoughts on that?
Bingo.
You know, I'll give the guy credit for getting a lot of publicity for writing a bullshit book. Okay, seriously. Wow. You know, I think like, I've written a lot of books. I've written a lot of books.
Tom's on one today. Tequila Tom is my favorite Tom.
That's nothing. Hey, I'm all for writing books. I've written 41 of them, okay? I know what it takes. I write nonfiction. He writes fiction. To say that there's zero valedictorians that have been successful, this guy's a nerd that got shot down by a valedictorian, and he's probably a virgin. I mean, if you break through this. Okay, here's some names. Are these people not successful? Hillary Clinton, Conan O'Brien, Cindy Crawford, Kevin Spacey, Jodie Foster,
Cindy Crawford was a valedictorian?
Yes, she was in DeKalb, Illinois, and you can look all these up. Kai, verify him for me. So for him to say zero's wrong, but good job getting the pump.
In his study, so he must have picked the certain people. Look, I think the key of what you mentioned here that relates so much is this talk about norms and not having visionary breakthrough ideas. And that's what California needs. Visionary breakthrough.
Here
idea.
We go.
Boom.
Holy. Hey! What in the AOC, MSNBC just happened? That was some solid spin. He's leaning into this whole politician thing. So, hey, he quoted.
At least you know how I feel.
He quoted Aristotle before. I'll quote Marilyn Monroe by saying, well-behaved women rarely make history, man. And that's the thing here, right? Like, what makes you a valedictorian? It's obedience, right? Like, you're smart, but high school's not hard. College isn't hard. They tell you exactly what to do, and then all you got to do is do what they tell you to do.
Wow.
There's no innovation in modern education. There's a literal syllabus. Yeah, they say, do this by
true,
this date,
but there's a little
and if you
competition
can do it,
because other people are trying to do it as well.
Sure,
so to stand
sure,
out amongst them,
fine, whatever. But I mean, yeah, but I mean, dude, I remember watching Pat with Jordan Peterson. He talked about disagreement. Remember, you talked about the ability to be disagreeable. All right, at one of my favorite interviews on this channel, and he was talking about like why are men predominantly more in positions of power and authority than women? And is it because of societal systemic issues? And Jordan Peterson said, yeah, some of it, but most of it is just because men have a predilection to being disagreeable. We don't mind disagreeing with one another, as you've seen at this table today. Whereas maybe it's the way women are raised, or maybe it's something to do nature or nurture, but they tend to want to avoid that conflict, at least in public, not necessarily in private, but in public. They don't want to be seen as being disagreeable. Mm-hmm. And that ability to be disagreeable is the number one determinant of your ability to rise through the ranks of business, right? So I think that there's something to be said for the way, and this goes back to the earlier conversation about education, there's something to be said for the way that we are systemically teaching people to be obedient, not to be intelligent. And that's something that we're doing. We are raising factory workers. We're raising people who need to show up at a certain time, clock in, clock out.
Corporate clones, basically.
That's it.
Yeah.
Our public education system is made so that people can effectively work at Amazon warehouses, not create a competitor to Amazon.
What's the story with Newsom suing his own elections chief over missing Democratic label on recall ballot? Did you hear about that
yes.
or no?
Oh,
what are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, we've actually got a legal team working on exactly that. So here's what's happening. Governor Newsom passed a law that says, hey, in a recall, the recall candidate can put his party preference on the ballot. So that way, instead of it saying, should Gavin Newsom be recalled, it says, should Gavin Newsom, a Democrat, be recalled.
Uh-huh.
It's marketing. It's marketing 101 in a Democratic state. It is very brilliant, that law they passed. But guess what? In the law he signed, he said, you have to make that determination at the beginning of the recall, which was February of 2020, this particular recall. He failed to do that, missed his own deadline, is now suing his own administration, calling it unfair, unconstitutional, and unreasonable. You know what's unfair, unconstitutional, and unreasonable?
The fact masks that you still wear in California?
The fact that he can raise unlimited amounts of money from anyone, and I can raise $32,400 per person. Recall candidates have campaign contribution limits. Governor Newsom does not. And yet he's saying in his own lawsuit that his own law that he signed into law is unconstitutional because other candidates can pick their party preference later.
When people would give me flack about voting libertarian, you're throwing your vote away, That 5% barrier is everything. If you can get to 5% of the national vote, it unlocks an entire different level of funding that you have access to and ballot access. You have to get 5% of the national vote in order to access this the funding equality and the
unpack that.
Yeah. So
unpack it.
So basically, right, like if anybody ever actually really cared to this is why Ross Perot was so important. When he got 18% of the vote, he essentially walked Clinton into office. He stole 18% of Bush's vote, right? He walked him in. So what he was able to do then is he had financial and ballot access the next time. That's why they begged him to run again. He was 4 years older. He didn't care. He just didn't want Bush. He hated Bush. He hated what the Bushes stand for. He actually never really wanted to be president. He wanted to use it for his personal brand. He wanted to get his point across, and he did that. And remember the 3-hour late night case studies with the biz doc that Ross Perot used to do every night? And this is why we need to get off oral. You know what I'm saying? He was talking about getting off our oil dependence before, you know, this was 25 years ago.
Yeah.
So, you know, the only way to stabilize the Middle East is we get off oil. Yeah, and that was this close to being president of the United States. So the idea is if you can get 5% of the national vote, If you get 5%, you have ballot access equality. So you have to be on the ballot for the next election cycle in every state, as opposed to having to petition for ballot access. And also, the way the media works is you have equal opportunity laws. So like if somebody gives a Democratic candidate X amount of airtime, they have to, you should know this, Tom, by law, give the Republican candidate the same amount of airtime if they request it. If you get 5% of the ballot access, now the Libertarian candidate, or whoever it was, can ask for that same amount of equal airtime. So they can't have a debate and not allow Gary Johnson on the stage. They can't have a debate and not allow Justin Amash on the stage. That 5% is everything. So with Gary Johnson in 2016, they got like 1.8%. And then with this clown show that they just had with Joe Jorgensen and Spike Cohen, it went down to like 0.9%. So they're going in the wrong direction. But 5% is everything. That 5% gives you a puncher's chance 4 years from that 5%.
Suing over a law that you voted in or that you signed is unbelievable. Any other politician does that, they're getting destroyed.
Well, then that's exactly why I think we have a legal team working on it. We want to sue and make that extremely clear. It's expensive to sue. It's probably going to cost $100,000 to get a temporary restraining order, which you can get out as early as next week, July 4th weekend, which slows things down, which is probably why Newsom filed his lawsuit when he did, right before July 4th weekend. But it's all to bury his own mistakes, his own hypocrisy of his own policies in other news. And I mean, look, marketing wise, I get it, but it's a scam.
You know, here's a big question in California. Is there a silent majority out there that has to support Gavin Newsom because he's a Democrat and you got to put the sign on in your front yard because you are under so much pressure to have those political beliefs if you live in California? You literally cannot admit that you're a Republican. It's career suicide. Could these people be stepping up and going and actually getting him out?
I hope so. And that's why I'm running, is I believe that this is not a Republican recall. It's a Californian recall. And Californians need a new, better option. And that's me.
By the way, he's absolutely right. The numbers are, you know, out of the recall votes, I think it's 79% or 80% is Republicans, but 20% are Democrats. So it's not like it's just Republicans calling out. You know how he'll always say this is a Republican recall? It's not. Yeah. It's actually not. It's people on both sides that are not happy about it.
Yeah, and he's spinning that totally. That's all he's branding it as a right-wing nut job. Yeah. Like QAnon is going after him or something.
Speaking of nut jobs, do you think there are people that are going to look at you sitting at a table with four men in close proximity with no mask on and say, this guy can't lead us?
We don't have to wear masks anymore.
Where? For the next California?
Few weeks, yeah. Even since in California. Delta variant.
It's the Delta variant.
On the 15th, those requirements went away, so you can actually.
Oh, that's nice. Yeah.
On the 15th, masks went away in California.
Yeah, for 2 weeks we've been.
Do you feel unsafe?
So the story came out just a couple days ago saying you have to wear masks and you got everybody
wear
masks
that?
Again.
She's suggesting
Chris
that we wear
Paul
masks indoors again.
Chris Paul was wearing masks in interviews.
Yeah, on Zoom meetings.
Yeah. Stop. And how you do
Zoom
that, I have no
meetings.
Idea.
You can't get a computer. You wear a mask in a Zoom meeting,
Kevin,
you don't get a computer virus.
What's it going to take for you to leave the state of California? Anything or no?
It's getting this recall to happen. That's what it's
say
going
it
to
doesn't
take.
Happen. Would you ever leave the state of California?
I thought you said lead.
No, leave. Leave state of California.
Lead. We got to get the recall down.
Because you see some of your peers who are YouTubers, they're leaving California, going to Tennessee, Nevada, Florida, Texas. Uh-huh. Would you ever leave the state of California if it got any worse?
It's tough. It's something that has actually been probably the biggest issue in our family at home. Is I am so frustrated with California, and it's why I'm running, because California is such a great and beautiful place. The weather is so beautiful. Only 7% of the world has the Mediterranean climate. Where I live, I've got the Mediterranean climate. And so many things I love about California. But the things that I hate about California, seeing people die on the streets, the housing unaffordability, the regulation, how long it takes me to get a building permit for a ceiling fan. It takes me 8 weeks to permit a ceiling fan. Because, staff cuts. And the fire department's coming over to my house
going... 8 weeks for a ceiling fan.
Yeah. I got the fire department coming over, Kevin.
Gotta love it.
We've got the fire department. Spoke to the fire department. We've got millions of dollars ready to build a new fire station, but we can't get the authorization to do it. Meanwhile, our response times are going down and Californians are suffering. It's all of the agencies throughout our state that are suffering. And that's what's so sad, is California in aggregate knows that there are problems. We just need a stronger leader. But yeah, I'm a big proponent of, in our family, of saying, look, the taxation, the lack of representation we get is a driver to move to the beach in Florida, to move to Texas and start a new company or a large media business in Texas or South Florida or whatever. They would welcome you with open arms. Here's your space. Here are your permits. You're operating right away. It's the opposite. It's the opposite in California. And so there's so many things that drive me out. Now, Lauren, my wife, doesn't want to leave because of friends and family. It makes sense.
Yeah.
So it is California's problems have driven a wedge into our relationship because they're so bad, the problems in California.
How often are you seeing that happen, by the way? How much are you seeing that in marriages right now, families right now, friendships?
Friendships getting destroyed. Certainly identity politics doesn't help. That destroys a lot of relationships as well. But the problems in California bring those identities out.
Yeah.
So lots of relationships.
Pat, I think if you came back to California for a month and you spent there, I think the one thing that you would notice is they've gotten rid of glamour. Glamour used to define California. It used to be something that drawed people in. It was
the
glamorous.
Dream. You're
it was sexy.
The dream.
LA, the lifestyle, Hollywood. Yeah. The way Hollywood is being run right now, it is completely destroyed glamour. You drive through the streets of West Hollywood, you feel depressed. You see the advertisements on the billboards now. Yeah. It's all negative content. It's stuff you don't want to watch. It's
That's
just
not California,
driven.
Tom.
No,
That's
not.
America. America, man.
Yeah,
there's
know,
no
but
more
California
heroes. It's
was
all
always
victims.
Different. You know, it always had that gleaming thing that people wanted to go to, and it's just they've gotten rid of glamour, and that's really depressing.
FYI, Sultan SJK, who gave $500, who moved here from New York City, if you want to apply for a job, send us an email. Text us at 310-340-1132, 310-340-1132. We will schedule an interview with you. Kevin, final thoughts. California, how do you envision this thing taking place? Over the next, what's the timeline with the recall right now? How much time do we got?
We've got probably either the first week, second week of September through the first week of November. That's our range for when the election is, which makes it really hard to campaign to figure out when you want to do your rallies. But look, the issue that a lot of Californians don't understand right now is the recall is one ballot. A lot of folks right now believe, oh, okay, I'll vote on the recall, and if Gavin's recalled, then I'll look at the backup options. Doesn't work that way. You get one ballot. Should Gavin Newsom be recalled, yes or no? Pick your backup. It's on one ballot. And so if California wants those 20 changes, especially the top five, which are the number one priority for year number one, solving homelessness, traffic, community policing, and our future schools, right? The other issues that we've talked about, then California should vote yes on that recall and vote yes on Meet Kevin Paffrath for governor. Go to meetkevin.com to support.
Put the link below, Kai. Meetkevin.com. Meetkevin.com. If you like what he stands for, smash that thumbs up button, subscribe to the channel, and go give to his campaign. With that being said, we're going to do this again. Is it again next Tuesday?
Yes, sir.
We're doing next Tuesday, same time. Kevin, thank you so much for coming out here. Really enjoyed it, and I
you
hope the audience
over,
enjoyed it just as much as we did as well.
Thank you, guys.
Thanks for coming out.
It's been a pleasure. Absolutely.
Appreciate
you. Thank you so much.